This is Freddie and Fitzsimmons on ESPN Radio.
And on the ESPN app.
Let it roll. I hear you. It is good to be with you again on Freddie and Fitzsimmons. I'm Freddie Coleman. Glad to be doing the show tonight with my man Myron Medcalf. You usually hear him on the weekends, part of game day, each and every Sunday from noon until 4 Eastern time. Myron, you've usually been a guest with me. Now we get to run the show together. Who's getting fired for making that decision?
I like it, man. I'm happy to have the opportunity.
Yeah, I'm happy that you have the opportunity as well. We're going to have a lot of fun tonight. You can reach out to us on Twitter. His handle at Medcalf by ESPN. My handle at Coleman ESPN, part of the 1-800-Flowers.com Twitter feed. We're 40 minutes away from the difference with the Cleveland Cavaliers. In 30 minutes, we'll talk about more lack of responsibility involving USA Gymnastics right here in the ESPN app and Sirius XM Channel 80. Raise your hand if you're surprised that Chris Paul, Blake Griffin, and James Harden did not get suspended by the NBA after what happened on Monday. Put your hands down. You know that no one expected any of those three guys to be suspended. Trevor Ariza, Myron, and also Gerald Green, they both got suspended two games for their part. Chris Paul, the instigator, got nothing, but we all knew he was not going to be suspended.
Yeah, he was going to find a way to get out of this, and it's just amazing how in 24 hours the entire narrative has shifted from Chris Paul leading the pack of Houston Rockets to the opposing locker room through a secret tunnel, which takes some effort. I mean, if you're really trying to get somebody, if you go through a secret tunnel, to Gerald Green, who got there, what, like Tuesday? Didn't he just join the team?
Well, he was playing pickup basketball at LA Fitness with the relatives on January 1st, and now here he is in the NBA starting stuff.
Already suspended, and then right. Trevor Ariza. It is baffling how things have switched. But my theory is, as they're making their way through the tunnel, Chris got a text on the Cliff Paul phone from State Farm, and State Farm said, "Look, we don't need this problem. We are selling insurance left and right this season. We do not need this problem." And I think that's when things changed at some point on the way to the other locker room.
And when you're a star, you're going to get a lot of leeway being a star, because the reports were out there that James Harden was among the guys that went over to the locker room, but yet not one suspension coming down on the head of James Harden. And I have two reasons for that. And you can say the NBA was smart or not smart to do this. The NBA understands about business. Number one, if you suspend James Harden and Chris Paul, this still becomes a story. This stays a story in the NBA because of their names being out there. If you put Blake Griffin in the middle of that, then this story does not go away. This is the best way for the NBA and Adam Silver, the commissioner, in my opinion, to make sure this goes away quicker. Nobody's going to talk about Trevor Ariza and Gerald Green being suspended. But if Blake Griffin had gotten suspended, if Chris Paul had gotten suspended, and James Harden got suspended, then that becomes a storyline that you don't want in the NBA. That's number one. Number two, Myron, the first NBA telecast for ABC Saturday Night Basketball happens this weekend when you have Golden State taking on the Houston Rockets. There was no way the NBA was going to have Chris Paul and James Harden suspended for two games with that telecast coming up 3 days from now.
Yeah, and that is a huge element of all this. It's like you look at the two people who are affected, and how many people even know much about Gerald Green, you know, being with the Houston Rockets? Like, the names didn't fit with the superstars who were involved going into it. When the report hit, it was, man, Chris Paul is starting fights and taking people through secret tunnels. And now a very predictable thing has happened, as you've said. And, you know, the NBA suspends the two people who, you know, we thought were just kind of going along for the ride, and left Chris Paul and James Harden. Not just that, Freddie, they're saying that they were the peacemakers somehow. That's the weird thing to me, is they went from the guys leading them to the tunnel to, okay, now they're the peacemakers in all of this. I'm just trying to figure out how the NBA was so certain with whatever they think Ariza and Green did. And you know, I guess so confident that Paul and Harden had nothing to do with it. That's the part that seems baffling to me.
Well, Shannon Penn, our producer, he relayed this information to me, that the NBA investigated close to 20 people. The NFL can't investigate one person in a week.
Exactly.
The NBA investigated 20 people, talked to 20 people about this, and then they came to this conclusion not even 48 hours later. We need the NBA to work for the FBI, the CIA, to be in charge of investigations, because you were able to contact 20 people in a 48-hour period. The NFL had the flake gate last 18 months, and they didn't talk to a soul until they finally came to a conclusion to suspend Tom Brady. So whoever Adam Silver has in employed, Myron, to be in charge of things like this. We need these people to use those powers for good or better good instead of just this with the Clippers and Rockets that happened on Monday night.
They got to the bottom of it fast, which usually means that maybe somebody talked. You know, maybe somebody saw the headlines and said, yeah, we don't need Chris Paul and James being involved. Let's make sure we sort this out. Gerald Green, you can take the hit, you know, and then, hey, yeah, Trevor, why don't you take this as well? Because this, I mean, it was crazy last night how people were talking as if this thing was all Chris Paul. And Chris Paul was the one talking the most trash during the game. And Blake Griffin doesn't get anything. He threw an elbow, according to a coach who said that, yeah, he caught an elbow from him. I mean, is that right, D'Antoni? Is that really what happened? I'm not sure. But looking on TV, there was contact, clearly, but nothing happens to Blake Griffin. Somehow, Chris Paul finds another way to get out of this, and Gerald Green has to miss two games. And nobody's going to see that hair. I mean, he had his hair braided with the R specifically so people could see that when he's on the bench, and now we're going to miss out on that for two games.
Yeah, you know, well, hey, get your hair done properly. Like, do that well before and be on national television a lot sooner than Saturday night. Real quick, right now, Alabama's upset Auburn. Auburn, number 17 team in the country. Their 14-game winning streak was snapped. Alabama beats number 17 Auburn 76-71, pulling one of the two upsets of the night. SMU beating number 7 Wichita State early. They took care of them on the road in that one. Myron Metcalf and Freddie Coleman, part of Freddie and Fitzsimmons on ESPN Radio and the ESPN app. Adrian Wojnarowski does a great job as an ESPN NBA insider. When he was on SportsCenter, he talked about the suspension and why two got it and three of the named players did not.
What went into this disciplinary process? I understand you just talked to Kiki Vandeweghe not long ago.
I did, guys. And talking to Kiki Vandeweghe from the league office, they did interviews with over 20 people involved in this, from players, team officials, security, and came away with an assessment that Chris Paul and James Harden had acted as peacemakers, that their verbiage around Ariza and Green going into the locker room was about trying to slow them down, get those two out. But the two-game suspension for Green and Ariza was centered around them aggressively entering the Clipper locker room, looking for a verbal, at the very least, a verbal altercation with Austin Rivers, and essentially the league decided it is, you know, as Vandeweghe said, it's unacceptable. It's a potentially dangerous situation to have a player go right from the court into another team's locker room. There's also no penalties for the Clippers' Blake Griffin. The league did look at his bump or his brush with Mike D'Antoni during the game and concluded that D'Antoni, that it wasn't intentional. That D'Antoni, you know, certainly the heat of an intensely contested game, and they gave, you know, no penalties beyond Ariza and Gerald Green, who get the two-game suspension now.
You know what this reminds me of? Chris Paul, who's the one that instigated all this, and you knew there were going to be some heated moments with him coming back. They had the video tribute for him before the game, returning in his first game as a member of the Houston Rockets, taking on his former team. There wasn't a standing ovation. There was polite applause from the fans. They have not forgotten how he left to go to Houston. Chris Paul, with that baby face, with the way that he interacts and operates, he is just like the guy in the barbershop that starts an argument, gets people heated, and gets out of there before the damage is done. He's the kind of guy that says, you know, Republicans stink or Democrats stink. And one person takes one side, the other person takes the other side. The next thing you know, that guy's out the barbershop heading to Kentucky Fried Chicken, getting a two-piece and on his way home. That's Chris Paul. Chris Paul does this all the time, and then he gets away with it because of his competitiveness, the way he looks, and that smiling face. But usually when something like this is happening and he's in the middle of it, he always seems to be able to get away scot-free, Myron, when it's all said and done.
Yeah, I mean, that's his thing. Because to me, if you're the peacekeeper, aren't you the peacekeeper in your own locker room? Isn't that where it starts? Like, you just start by saying, yeah, we don't want to go over there.
That's a good point.
So to go to the opposing locker room, apparently through some back way or whatever it was, clearly Chris Paul has to be a part of that. And to me, he was the most aggravated, agitated dude in the entire game. Mm-hmm. And I can see his emotion carrying over and saying, hey, dudes, let's go, you know. And then at some point, I don't know if they saw the wrong kind of security guards or what, standing outside the locker room, like, you know, Junior might have been out there trying to get that knockout bonus. But, you know, whatever happened, all of a sudden he becomes the peacemaker. It was his actions that elevated the energy in that game and that made things so intense. What's interesting to me, Freddie, is we're not that far removed from when he joined a bunch of other Clippers to save DeAndre Jordan, right?
Right.
Like, that was that whole thing. So it's right. amazing how we went from that point where we thought they were all one big happy family to the situation we're in now.
Amazing. Not surprised that Chris Paul, Blake Griffin, and James Harden did not get suspended, especially when they're about to play Golden State on Saturday. But Gerald Green and Trevor Ariza, enjoy the time at home because you're going to be there for a couple of games while your Houston Rockets go on the road and try to take care of business on Thursday and also Saturday night versus Golden State. Freddie Fitzsimmons with Freddie coming to Meyer Metcalf, brought to you by Pennzoil Synthetics, taking synthetic motor oil to a whole new level. Make the switch to Pennzoil Synthetics today. The Fall Guy when it comes to the Pittsburgh Steelers. That's next on ESPN Radio. Freddie and Fitzsimmons with Freddie Coleman and Meyer Metcalf on ESPN Radio, the ESPN app and Sirius XM Channel 80 presented by Progressive Insurance. Anytime a guest stops by to hang out with us, they're here thanks to Shell Pennzoil Performance Line. Phone number is always there for you at 888-SAY-ESPN. 888-729-3776. Want to hear what you have to say about the fall guy in Pittsburgh, meaning Todd Haley, the offensive coordinator. Reports are out there that he was fired by the Pittsburgh Steelers, so he's out. They have a new offensive coordinator in who used to be the quarterback's coach for the Steelers. He is now taking the place of Todd Haley. It was interesting what Bill Polian, Hall of Famer and ESPN NFL front office insider, had to say about this move. He said this move maybe goes a lot deeper with that organization.
There's a lot of talk, especially on the internet, about Mike Tomlin underachieving. Mike Tomlin didn't underachieve. Haley didn't underachieve. The only part of that football team that underachieved was the defense. And that was missing Shazier for this last month of the season in this playoff run. So in that sense, this record and the way this season finished is understandable and somewhat puzzling in the sense that the offensive coordinator was responsible for the greatest performance in offensive performance in Steeler playoff history is out the door. So it has to be personality driven or some other, there's some other internal issue in the organization.
Myron, you would think, even with Todd Haley and Ben Roethlisberger having their issues, you would think an offense against a Jacksonville defense, a number one pass defense, a top two pass defense that put up 42 points, had five touchdowns, almost 500 yards passing, but yet Todd Haley, the fall guy. Meanwhile, Keith Butler, who's deep, again, Ryan Shazier not there, that's going to affect any defense. Yeah. But even so, boy, oh boy, how much of this move was predicated on, hey, Keith Butler probably likes Big Ben. Randy Fichtner, coach, was a quarterback coach, and he likes Big Ben. Big Ben doesn't like Todd Haley. Todd Haley, pack your bags, you're out of here.
I think it was that simple. I mean, clearly some of the comments we've heard from Big Ben have suggested that, you know, there was a rift there, even in the game, some of the play calls. I think if you're Pittsburgh, you have to do something. You're not going to fire Mike Tomlin. That was a dumb idea to people who floated that. I mean, the guy is second in franchise history in his first 11 seasons with, I think, 116 victories. So he's not the issue. But I think Todd Haley, you got to do something there when your offense isn't clicking. For the second consecutive game against the Jacksonville Jaguars, Freddie, I think part of it is, where were the adjustments? Wait a minute. Okay, you got blown out in the first game. People kind of gave you a pass. It was early. Big Ben played his worst game ever. You look at this game and you go, well, where were the adjustments? Why were you still in a similar situation? Mm-hmm. Why wasn't the offense moving? I think that's where you look at Haley and go, we got to get somebody in here who can take advantage of these final Roethlisberger years and because they feel like they still have a chance to win it.
I'm just trying to your point. I hear what you're saying. But as far as I'm concerned, Todd Haley did that. Because here's what undermined Todd Haley, as far as I'm concerned. Those first two drives against Jacksonville. Jacksonville's run defense, number 21 in the NFL, their pass defense outstanding. And Le'Veon Bell did not get the ball enough in those first 5 to 10 plays. And you know, whether Ben Roethlisberger was upset about it or Mike Tomlin upset about it, somebody was upset enough to say, well, wait a minute. You're supposed to be that strategist that can take advantage of whatever the weakness of a defense is. We got a guy in Le'Veon Bell who was ready to run the football. He was ready to say, hey, give me the ball 35, 40 times. And yet we did not rely on him early enough when our defense was not up to snuff. Then you blinked your eyes, you're down 21 to nothing. I wonder how much of that, Myron, what happened on Sunday was the final nail for Todd Haley being the offensive coordinator? Because what if he decides to go the other way and he gets Le'Veon Bell enough? Or Ben Roethlisberger calling him out saying, I don't have to write the audible. You know, I just follow along the program. I wonder how much of those things, but those specific plays, the beginning of the game on Sunday, led to the demise of Todd Haley being offensive coordinator in Pittsburgh.
I think they were huge, and he probably didn't realize it because you had an opportunity, a small window, to get the offense rolling. You had to against a team that had destroyed you in the first meeting. This is a franchise that doesn't get rid of head coaches, so I think anybody under Mike Tomlin has to realize, if I don't do my job, even if there's a perception that I'm not doing my job, I'm vulnerable. And I think that's what happened to Todd Haley. They were going to do something, even with all the challenges they had. This felt like the move to make and to maybe get some fresh blood in there to try something different with this offense because it's too talented to struggle the way they did.
Don in Maui Waui, what do you got to say about the Steelers firing Todd Haley with Freddie coming to Myron Metcalf on ESPN Radio's Freddie and Fitzsimmons? Go ahead. Let's move on to Robbie in Missouri. Robbie in Missouri, what do you got to say about this, my friend?
Hey, what's going on, guys?
Good.
Hey. I think it's a two-sided coin. Whenever you play Jacksonville the first time and you throw five picks and you maybe make an adjustment on offense, but I think it goes more to the defensive side and maybe the DB's coach, because I can't remember the last time that the Steelers had a set of corners that really made anybody scared. So I think it's more on the DB's coach, because when you give up that many points to Blake Bortles, even with that defense, it's Blake Bortles. You got to start looking at who's controlling the guys stopping their offense.
Yeah, and I honestly believe Todd Haley's a scapegoat in this whole thing because he did not get along with the quarterback. And we can say we want about Antonio Brown being the best receiver in the NFL. That's how I feel about him. Or Le'Veon Bell, if not the best running back in the NFL, he's definitely in that conversation. But for whatever reason, Todd Haley and Ben Roethlisberger, despite all that success, Myron, did not fit. Todd Haley was the scapegoat in this situation because Keith Butler's defense at times, they've had their moments, especially in the secondary. They allowed Blake Bortles to make key plays against them when he didn't do anything against the Buffalo Bills at home the week before.
Yeah, Blake obviously was a problem, clearly. But their biggest issue was Leonard Fournette again. I mean, he was the problem in the first game when they lost in regular season. He was a problem again. But a lot of that was offensively, field position, the pick. The fumble, I mean, they were doing things to really put themselves in a good position so they could go to Leonard Fournette in short yardage situations. And Blake Bortles, I mean, it's not like he was Elway or something, but he was just smart enough to make the plays they needed in the advantageous situations that he had. I just think when you have two consecutive losses, and the way that Ben Roethlisberger had improved, I think after that five-interception game, he threw seven interceptions over the final 11 games of the regular season. He was rolling coming into the playoffs, and then you do that. I think perception is everything in this league, and even though you could look at the defense and go, how'd you give up 45 points after giving up 30 in the first game? I think people still looked at that and said, why didn't Le'Veon Bell get more than 16 carries? Why didn't you do more to throw it downfield early when you had a chance? That has to be on the coordinator. Even if that's not true, that's perception, and I think that's why the move was made.
I still wonder how much of a hot seat will be there for Mike Tomlin going into this season, because it's one thing to fire your offensive coordinator, and if he's a scapegoat for what you're not doing as a head coach or what you should be doing as a head coach, I wonder how much of a hot seat or how much of a warm seat is there for Mike Tomlin. If they don't get to the Super Bowl or to an AFC Championship game next year, you may have to wonder if this was step one, the Pittsburgh changing everything with Todd Haley being out this year. Mike Tomlin may have to be careful going into next year. USA Gymnastics and this entity apparently still do not get it. That's next on ESPN Radio. Freddie and Fitzsimmons with Freddie Coleman and Myron Metcalf on ESPN Radio, Sirius XM Channel 80, as well as the ESPN app, presented by Progressive Insurance. The trail of human wreckage left by Larry Nassar may never be completely calculated. That's what ESPN investigative reporter John Barr told Bob Lee of Outside the Lines on the Tuesday edition. And apparently, Michigan State, where he used to work and was a team doctor for USA Gymnastics, they still don't get the damage that they've done, or they're trying to just completely let it slide by. Let's bring in Carron Phillips, who wrote a great article about this in the New York Daily News titled, Larry Nassar's Enablers Are a Latest Example of How Greed and Sexual Abuse Are Ingrained in Our Society. Carron is here thanks to the Shell Pinto Performance Line. You said you read the 7,000-page report. When you read that, Carron, Can you even describe what went through your mind reading that?
Man, so many words to kind of describe it. It was a great, I think it was like 7,000 words. I might have misquoted myself on the column, but it was a long read. Took me about a good 30, 45 minutes to get through it, because with something that heavy, it weighs on you, and you have to take breaks when you read that. Wow. But the one underlying thought that of all the words that went through my head was just the negligence, I guess, would be the best word to use in this situation, by all of the adults in something so disgusting and vile that went on for decades that was done to children, and how time after time there could have been instances and situations where an adult could have stepped in and did something more. But it seemed like every time that chance came, they turned a blind eye to it, or just didn't do enough because maybe they just didn't care.
Carron, I told you that I thought this was the best column you've written, man. I really mean that. And I'm just – USA Gymnastics clearly is at the center of this, and people are wondering what their reaction will be, haven't been pleased with it. What should they do? And I mean, how do you fix a system that seems so broken?
That's a great question, and it's something to where USA Gymnastics has, a huge target on their back, and they're under the microscope right now, dealing with the situation a couple of weeks or a month ago when we found out that they were trying to pay off, I believe it was Michaela Maroney from the team. They paid her like $1 million not to say anything. But I also hold Michigan State responsible as well, just because they employed the guy. He was an employee of their school, and how he kind of started out there and got into the business, and then was around USA for so long, and then was their team doctor. I hold both institutions. I think their hands are all dirty, and it's just the same.
Why haven't we talked more about Michigan State University's part in this as much as USA Gymnastics' part in this when it comes to Larry Nassar?
Because the situation with USA Gymnastics has been around in the news a little longer. We've heard gymnasts come out and say things, especially in the last 12 to 18 to 24 months. And it seems like that brand of U.S. Gymnastics just keeps popping up. And it's like, okay, they're the bad guys. When this Michigan State situation was going on, but maybe not getting enough coverage, and maybe that's on us in the media and us as journalists, is not paying enough attention to it. So this is kind of like the big first time where everyone's looking at Michigan State like, oh, wow, we didn't know you guys were doing this too. Mm-hmm. But they need to feel the heat as well, and any other parents or trainers from outside of that or in the area that could have been responsible as well.
You wrote that this country also has a problem listening to and believing victims of sexual assault and harassment. Do we have a problem with that in the media as well, specifically the sports media? And if so, how do we address that?
The same way that this whole situation is playing out now, from Hollywood to Harvey Weinstein, with Matt Lauer at the Today Show to House of Cards situation with Netflix. It seems like this whole Me Too movement has kind of been the story of the latter part of 2017. And it looks like it's not going to go away at all in 2018, which I'm pretty happy about. I did a column the end of last year where I spoke with a psychologist who deals with this kind of stuff, and she's down at Tulane University. And I asked her kind of the same question, and she said the good thing about this is that people are getting exposed and it's staying in the news, and awareness is happening, and people are starting to pay more attention. How do we fix it? I don't have the answer to that. I wish I did. It's probably a really hard and complicated way to deal with this, because if you really try to break it down layer by layer, then this is something that has been going on for years and decades and generations, and people keeping secrets in families and corporations. And where does that start, and how do you affect change? So is there a trickle-down effect, or does something big really need to happen now for an instant or sudden change? I'm really not clear in how to do that. I just hope something starts soon.
Great stuff by Carron Phillips from the New York Daily News. By the way, follow him on Twitter, Carron Jane Phillips. Joining Freddie Cohen and Maya Metcalf on ESPN Radio. At the end of the article you wrote for the New York Daily News, you said, so if our society wants to eradicate sexual assault, it must first admit how big of a problem it has. And secondly, realize how far some people are willing to go to cover up a scandal because it would be bad for business. Carron, do you ever think at certain points with stuff like this, how hard is it to do the right thing?
I don't think it's that hard to do the right thing, but obviously we've seen that it is. I mean, we're still, there are people still who are involved at Penn State on appeal right now, mm-hmm. which means they don't feel they did anything wrong.
Right.
And even though it's great to see from a sports, perspective, how good that football team has become and they've got past that. But Penn State is still an issue. Like, there are still adults who did things to children that need to be punished. And then we saw just a couple of years ago what Baylor's football team did. And so, you had all these instances and situations where you would think that the right choice is very easy to learn from other people's mistakes. But we just see that yet once again, people aren't doing the right thing. And I guess doing the right thing isn't such an easy thing to do.
You said that something sudden may have to happen to really change the system. Do you think this can be that? Can this situation specifically with USA Gymnastics be the catalyst for that change?
Hopefully, because if you read that ESPN piece or some of the work that other journalists who've done who have been in that Michigan courtroom, I read some stuff from CNN, and you really break down or watch some of the video from some of the victims' testimonies and how they've had a chance this week to, face Nassar in open court, which is brave of them in itself to be on camera and talk about what he did to them. But if you really just take 5 to 10 minutes, if you have it, and sit down and read some of the stuff and watch it and see the pain in their eyes. And while it may be disturbing to read what happened to these young girls, if you can read that or watch that and still not see the issue here, then your humanity needs to be questioned.
Carron, when you see Larry Nassar in the courtroom, what do you think?
I hope he gets everything that's coming to him.
You talked about big sports covering up issues like this.
Mm-hmm.
Why does it seem like we minimize these things at times? I mean, it seems like when the first reports come out, we go, well, we don't know. And then you have to get 125 women to say, no, this happened to me,
right,
before we go, whoa, it's a big deal. Why does that happen?
You know what? I don't know. That's one of those questions I really have to answer to, where you see there are 125 police reports and at least 150 women have said this has happened to them. And it's not like it was something recently. Like, these go back decades. And I think one situation I read started where he started with like a 6-year-old.
Yeah.
And it's like, why, like, I know people are like, kids can make up things, but like, what kind of kid makes up this? Like, I don't understand what victim would make something like this up, something so serious and something so like vile, to where we as adults, as journalists or people in the media or just, human beings, period. Why? I don't understand why we wouldn't take this serious and just believe it and dig a little deeper to understand what's fully going on right now.
The title of the article in the New York Daily News is Larry Nassar's Enablers Are Latest Example of How Greed and Sexual Abuse Are Ingrained in Our Society. It's a terrific article that was written by Carron Phillips. Follow him on Twitter. Carron J. Phillips did a great job breaking down this, and hopefully less breakdowns when it comes to adults violating kids, especially in sports. He joined Freddie Cohen and Myron Metcalf on Freddie and Fitzsimmons. Carron, it was a pleasure, my friend. Keep up the great work, and we'll talk to you soon.
All right. Thanks for having me, guys.
And by the way, you missed that conversation that we had with him. You can subscribe to the podcast. You can do that in the Listen tab of the ESPN app, Apple Podcasts, as well as TuneIn. Hopefully this will stop Myron sooner than later. But in our society, you just never know where another situation like this may rear its ugly head, especially in sports.
Yeah, I mean, we cheered for these gymnasts as they won a lot of medals, brought a lot of pride to the country, and we didn't know this was going on. So I hope we can prevent this somehow, doing what we have to do to change the system.
Yeah, no doubt about that. And it should not be hard to do the right thing or speak up when a wrong is happening. We shall see. Thanks for joining us on Freddie and Fitzsimmons. And coming up next, when it comes to LeBron James, he agrees with Freddie Cohen and Myron Metcalf. Why does he agree? Find out next on ESPN Radio.
Open road, you can take.
Freddie coming to Meyer Metcalf on Freddie and Fitzsimmons on ESPN Radio, the ESPN app, and Sirius XM Channel 80, presented by Home Progressive's Home Insurance. Excuse me. Get your quote at progressive.com today. Keep weighing in on Twitter. Always love to hear your tweets at the 1-800-Flowers.com Twitter feed. Getting a lot of great tweets all night long. My handle at Coleman ESPN. And, of course, not forgetting about Myron's handle at Metcalf by ESPN. So LeBron James sounds weary. LeBron James is starting to feel the heat. Three wins in their last 12 games. They're 2-9 since Christmas. He had a chance to speak on it, and he talked about exactly how hard this year has been for Team LeBron.
It's been very challenging, just from the simple fact of how many guys have been in and out. This is a difficult, year for our team. It seems like I say that every year, but this one has been much even more challenging. With everybody that's been out and coming back in and the rotations and things of that nature, has been very challenging on our team. But we have to figure it out. At the end of the day, we have a game every other day or every 2 days, just like everybody else in the NBA. And we have to go out and play.
The key words about the final part of that statement, just like everybody else in the NBA, I don't want to hear it. And I'm a LeBron James fan. But just like everybody else in the NBA, Myron, that has to deal with stuff, I don't want to hear his combat stories on this. This is what he wanted. He wanted that power to sign off on deals and have this player come in or that player go away. They have given him those kind of keys to the kingdom. He signed off on Dwayne Wade. He signed off on Derrick Rose. He signed off on these guys. So for him to say, man, this has been one of the hardest years everybody goes through in the NBA, but woe is me. LeBron, I love you, bro. I don't want to hear it. Handle it or be handled. There's no in-between there with me.
Yeah, he's not getting any sympathy from anybody, and he shouldn't, like you said. I mean, his power is why Kyrie wanted to go somewhere where there wasn't a player with that power. Kyrie wanted to be a guy who felt like he had some control. So you have this personality, and you know you have a certain reputation. Obviously, his talent is unquestionable, but I think this is one of those years where he hasn't put together the right combination. You bring in Isaiah Thomas, even when he's healthy, that's a defensive liability. Say what you want about Kyrie Irving, but when it was time to play defense in clutch situations, as much as he was criticized, Kyrie brought it. Right. Kyrie could play defense in those scenarios. That's not IT. You got an aging Dwayne Wade. Derrick Rose hasn't been healthy. So you've got all these different pieces, and it's just not working. I mean, they're worse defensively this year. They're worse offensively this year than they were a year ago. And as good as LeBron is, as much as everybody expects him to put on the cape and just save the day, this feels like one of those years where he won't be able to do that. The gap seems too wide between Cleveland and some of these younger teams that they're going to have to fight through to find a way to get a high seed and make another run back to the finals for the eighth time with LeBron James. I just think this feels way different than some of those other situations where LeBron bailed him out.
And I've been saying this for about a week. Shannon Penn, Scott Cienki, all these guys trying to say, well, Freddie, it's still LeBron James. He'll find a way. And they go through this every January when Ian Fitzsimmons, he was on the show and talking about that before he went on vacation. Oh, Freddie, they go through a ditch every January. This is just a ditch. And I said, this feels different. You and LeBron James and I are in the same box. He knows it's different because he clearly understands that all those other years when they went through those January swoon, that January lull, he was still great enough where he could overcome those mistakes. LeBron James has played a lot of basketball. He's gone through a lot of challenging situations. He can't do it the way that he used to do it, and it's okay. But you know what? Myron, this is what he signed up for. So, yeah, it feels different, especially now when LeBron looks at that and says, well, before, I could handle it. Now, I don't know if I'm capable of handling that, and we may not even get to the NBA Finals. There's a potential we may not even get out of the Eastern Conference, because I'm sure everybody in the Eastern Conference that is a contender feels a lot more emboldened now that LeBron and Cleveland have come back to the pack in the East.
Oh, yeah. This feels like a changing of the guard, 100%. I mean, in the East, this feels like, we're going to have some new competition for the Eastern Conference title and a chance to play the Warriors in the West. Like, this feels different, as you've been saying these last couple of weeks. I mean, LeBron will age at some point, And I think LeBron will be 40 years old, Freddie, and still be able to contribute to a team and still be able to put up double-doubles and average 5 assists a game. Like, I think he's that kind of player where we've never seen anyone like him genetically, anyone like him who takes care of his body the way that he does. But where the age is going to catch up with him is he's not going to be able to push that red button and turn into Superman as many times the older he gets. And I think that's what he's saying. He's saying, yes, I can be this player, but I don't have as many of these left in me the way I did 4 or 5 years ago when I was in my late 20s. And they're going to have to manage that because you don't want to burn him out going into the playoffs and then he can't play that role. Kyrie Irving was very, very good. And he was a great compliment to LeBron James. Did a lot of things that open up the floor for everybody on that team, and now he's gone. You don't replace him with an IT who's undersized and he's a defensive liability. You don't replace him with a Derrick Rose who hasn't been healthy. That's the issue. I mean, we can talk about all these other things. Kyrie was a really good player who left in his prime, and they haven't been able to fill that void.
Great stuff on Meyer Metcalf with Freddie Cohen on Freddie and Fitzsimmons on ESPN Radio. Here's something else when it comes to Team LeBron. We know that Team LeBron is less worried about Team Cleveland than he is about Team LeBron. And I wonder how much of what he said is not so much for the team this year that he's on, but wherever he's going to be after this season. Because wherever he decides to go, he's going to be the man. Outside of, he's not going to Golden State. That's not happening. But let's say if he's looking west, maybe L.A., maybe Houston, he doesn't want to go there and be a ragamuffin where people look at him and say, oh, poor LeBron. Remember when he was great a year ago? Now he's just a run-of-the-mill. He's just an ordinary guy. LeBron does not want to be that ordinary guy. Wherever he decides to go, and I'm starting to slide away from him staying in Cleveland, that he's going to go elsewhere. He's not going to want to go to that team, and he put everything on the line for this team, and he has nothing to give the way he wants and needs to give wherever he's going to be next year. I wonder how much of that, saying that this has been a challenging year, this has been a hard year, this feels different, is a lot about the future LeBron James and not the near future LeBron James and Team LeBron with Team Cleveland.
Oh, I agree. I think he's always a step ahead of everybody else, and I think he's always thinking about putting himself in the best position. His teammates should be concerned if he starts demanding everybody play Tupac and he starts rapping the lyrics to California Love. Like, you might be concerned about where he's going to end up if that change starts happening here the rest of the way. But I think LeBron is going to put himself in a position to have the longest career possible at the highest level possible, whether that's in Cleveland or somewhere else. Right now, it doesn't feel like Cleveland is a place that gives him that opportunity.
Especially when the guys he needs are not thinking about going to Cleveland to help him out. More respect for Lonzo Ball? Find out who says we should next on ESPN Radio and the ESPN app.
This is Freddie and Fitzsimmons.
Here we go.
On ESPN Radio.
And on the ESPN app.
Freddie coming to Meyer Metcalf and Freddie and Fitzsimmons, brought to you by Dallas Shave Club. Upgrade to shaving with a fresh blade whenever you want for a fraction of the price. Join DollarShaveClub.com today. That is DollarShaveClub.com. Petty Paul Pierce? That comes your way in 10 minutes. 30 minutes from the Super Bowl matchup you do not want to see in 2018. That comes your way in 30 minutes on the ESPN app and Sirius XM Channel 80. Always reach us anytime you want. 888-SAY-ESPN, 888-729-3776. Want to get your response to Myron Metcalf saying that we should start respecting Lonzo Ball more. Myron Metcalf, what say you, sir?
Well, I just think if we could reset the season and get rid of the LeVar Ball sidebars, right, and just grade him as a teenager, as the starting point guard of the Los Angeles Lakers, which is unlike any experience in the NBA, I think there would be a different perception on his promise. Now, I don't think he's Ben Simmons or some of these other phenomenal rookies we've seen, but I think a guy averaging 7 assists, 7 rebounds, 10 points a game, he's not shooting very well from the three-point line, even though he did in college. I just think people would look at that guy and go, man, that's a building block, especially with the Lakers, who have a bunch of cap space, who can create a bunch of cap space this summer and sign 2 big superstars. I just think he's a guy who's still being judged by the cloud that his father has created, and not being given a fair chance to really earn, I think, some of the praise that he deserves. I'm not saying he's, should be essentially lauded with praise and it should be over the top, but you look at those numbers. There are a lot of teams that would love a dude averaging 10-7-7, and there just aren't many rookies who've ever done that. But I think the LeVar Ball stuff makes people go, I don't like that guy. And they don't like him because of anything he's done.
Right.
It's because of all the off-court stuff that he really has nothing to do with. And I think that's unfair.
I can't remember in any kind of memory, no matter how high the draft choice, where problems that are affecting him or could be affecting him, could be affecting his team, have nothing to do with him. To your point, the whole brouhaha that happened with his brother overseas as a member of the UCLA basketball, involved in shoplifting, his dad and all the shenanigans that he's brought to the table. I keep warning y'all, stop giving LeVar Ball a microphone and you won't have to worry about it. He'll go away eventually. You keep putting a microphone in front of his face because he's good copy and he's good theater. Well, it's the genie in the bottle. You got to get everything that comes with it. And yet you have a guy, Lonzo Ball, who by all accounts, based on what I've seen, based on what I've heard, Myron, seemed to be a pretty good dude, pretty intense kid, pretty likable kid. And I use the word kid because he's 19 years of age. But with all of this, and before he got drafted, and even after he got drafted, I said, the scrutiny is not going to break him, but it's not going to allow him to have a break. It's not going to allow him to have a leeway. I have a honeymoon period where people are going to say, let's give this kid a break. I said either he's going to be really, really fantastic in terms of a really great player, or he was going to be a bust. There was not going to be anything in between. And we'll see. He's just scratching the surface of his NBA career. So when anybody says he's a bust or he's going to wash out, we still don't have enough of a sample size. We still don't have enough to say right or wrong one way or the other. But because of all of this, you have to wonder at a certain point, when does he stand up and say, I know you're my father, but knock it the hell off already, because you're not making anything better for anybody. You're not making me better. You're not making the situation better. You're making things harder on me. You think you're doing this to protect me? All you're doing is bringing more of the spotlight and more of the scrutiny on me, where I'm not allowed to breathe to be the best player that I can be for this organization.
See, I think that's actually complicated, Freddie, in that I think there are some things his father says because he's sort of the sounding board. He's the guy, the mouthpiece for the family sometimes. So I think there have been situations where LeVar has said things that Lonzo won't say.
Really?
And I think that's part of the challenge. Like, I wonder with the Luke Walton stuff, is that all LeVar? Or is that after conversations with Lonzo, who's communicating, man, it's just not working out in this locker room? But I think at some point, maybe later in his career, he'll have that moment where he has to make a decision about the role his father's going to play. But that's not going to happen now. I mean, a lot of players, Kobe Bryant with Jelly Bean Bryant, and a lot of young stars have had, you know, these influential fathers or role models who wanted to make sure they were going in the right direction. And you could certainly make the case that LeVar has done far too much of that and made life a lot harder on Lonzo Ball. But I think Lonzo, in terms of the building blocks of a team, a 6'6 point guard who has been as versatile as he has been. And I know everyone's writing him off because they're saying he can't shoot. Boris Diaw couldn't shoot when he came into the NBA. Like, Boris Diaw was a joke. His second year in the NBA, he made 18% of his threes. 18%. And 3 or 4 years later, he was shooting 41% from the three-point line and was known as like a reliable three-point shooter. So I'm not sold on this idea that Lonzo will never find a way to shoot again. He could do it in college. I think this guy has the building blocks to be a great player one day. I just don't know if he'll ever be able to emerge from the cloud that his father has created and really reach his potential on and off the court. That's going to be the big question for him.
My Metcalf and Freddie Cohen and Freddie and Fitzsimmons on ESPN Radio, presented by Progressive Insurance. I'm going to go back to what you said in terms of the dad being a sounding board, and if Lonzo feels that way, he's going to talk to somebody close to him, because I don't know how close he is to teammates on that basketball team, but I guarantee they're not going to be any closer than he is with his family. Let's say he did that. Let's say he went to his dad and said, I think Luke Walton has lost the locker room. If that's the case, I'm looking at him sideways in that Lakers locker room, because I know, and he's 19 years of age. He has not, think about it, this is the first time he's been in a social situation that does not have a Ball family member as a part of it. So he may be trying to manage that minefield, trying to figure out who to hang out with, who to be around, who not to be around. And he's always going to go back to the strength of his being, and that is the family dynamic. But if he's doing something like that, putting locker room business out for public consumption with his own family, then he should be looked at sideways in the locker room from his teammates. Because you can't do that, as far as I'm concerned. Not saying you can't share information, but there's certain information you probably can't share with your dad, especially when it comes to the Lakers. The minute, if this is true, I'm going by what you said. Yeah, I'm not saying you have any knowledge of that. But if that's the case, and he shared that with his dad, then, you know, if you're Lonzo Ball, you got to be better than that. You can't put that out there and tell your dad, because you know what he's going to do with that information. He's going to run and tell everybody, say, Luke Walton's lost the team, and he's lost control. Do something about this. He's not coaching my son properly. You can't do that, especially when you're not playing with your dad. You're playing with these guys that are going to be the key to your fortune if you're going to rise and fall as a player. If I have any information like that, the last person I'm telling, if I'm Lonzo Ball, is my dad, who's never met a microphone that he did not want to speak into to raise his name and raise that brand.
Yeah, I think maybe in scenarios where the player is maybe more mature and doesn't already have that dynamic, but I think it's safe to assume, based on what we already know, that they probably talk about everything. Mm-hmm. And I don't believe that. You know, every time Lonzo's interviewed, he says, I haven't talked to my dad since he went to Lithuania. I haven't talked to my dad since the draft. Like, come on, man.
Yeah, I'm not buying that either. I'm with you.
I think you're talking to your dad a lot more than that. And let's remember, if this thing works out, Lonzo Ball is the L.A. native who has a chance to be a star and a superstar in his hometown for the storied Los Angeles Lakers. There's a lot attached to that as well. I mean, he's going to be looking out for Lonzo in all this. So I'm not saying he put out there the Luke Walton stuff, but I can guarantee if there's a situation where he feels it's not going to help him become who he wants to be for this franchise, I think he will speak up in some way, but I don't think he'll ever do it publicly. I think he would do it through his father. But just that element alone makes you wonder, do you want to play with a guy like that, as promising as he is? And I think all those things hurt Lonzo. But if we just look at Lonzo, forget all the other stuff, there are many guys who could average 10-7-7 as a rookie in the NBA. That, to me, is an impressive start for that guy, and he deserves more respect for that. I just don't think he'll ever get it, considering all the other factors.
Well, look at it this way. It becomes that if you're a player like that, in this day and age in the NBA, you have to be sort of a Pied Piper. You have to be someone that guys want to play with. If there's a circus surrounding you, even if you have nothing to do with it, but if there's a circus surrounding you, plenty of guys look at the Lakers and say, nah, I'm good. Your dad's still running his mouth? Still bringing that unrest to everybody? I don't got time with him messing with the team dynamic and potentially messing with my money, because if we're not winning, he's not going to shut up. And if we are winning, he's still not going to shut up. NBA players, Myron, we know this. They have egos. The last thing you want is somebody who's not an NBA player, who is a Kim Kardashian, as Steve Kerr called them, of the NBA, interrupting what you're trying to do. I wonder how much of that could be a detriment with guys thinking about the Los Angeles Lakers. They may like Lonzo Ball, but they don't want anything else that goes with it, being around him and being around that.
I think that is a serious challenge and factor that Magic Johnson will have to navigate this offseason. Because if LeBron comes to you and says, look, I want to be here, but I don't want LeVar Ball around, and that's going to be a difficult decision. Maybe it won't be a difficult decision for Magic Johnson, but I can certainly see that. And the other thing is that this isn't the era where you got to play in New York, you got to play in L.A. These dudes got enough money where they all play in L.A. Right. In the offseason. They all got houses in Los Angeles and Miami and all these other places. They don't have to play there.
Right.
So it's a different deal. These guys want to win. And obviously LeBron James will go wherever he has to go to win. He's done it in Miami, going back to Cleveland. He'll go wherever. So I think if you're Magic Johnson, you got to make a decision. How involved should LeVar Ball be from here on out? Is this going to ruin this franchise and my job?
Can you imagine the circle of death involving LeVar Ball and LeBron James on the same basketball team in the same organization? That would be a 30 for 30 to end all 30 for 30s. You can always reach at the 1-800-Flowers.com Twitter feed. The show's handle at ESPN Radio, my handle at Coleman ESPN, and Myron's handle at Metcalf by ESPN. And no matter what the weather is outside, you can always brighten a day with 1-800-Flowers.com. When you order a dozen multicolored roses for only $29.99, you'll get another dozen absolutely free. Just go to 1-800-Flowers.com/ESPN. The Boston Celtics could have made this Paul Pierce, Isaiah Thomas night fiasco non-existent. Find out how next on ESPN Radio. Freddie Cohen and Myron Metcalf from Freddie and Fitzsimmons on ESPN Radio, the ESPN app, and Sirius XM Channel 80. So we had the whole deal that will not go away when it comes to the Boston Celtics and the Paul Pierce night and the Isaiah Thomas night. And in case you missed it, they were going to have a Paul Pierce retirement jersey ceremony night earlier this month. Well, it was going to be on the same night that Isaiah Thomas was making his first appearance back in that place as a member of the Cleveland Cavaliers. Well, Paul Pierce did not want to share the night with him. Isaiah Thomas wound up saying, look, if this is going to cause this much consternation, then I don't want this to happen at all as well. So it still has continued where they're still going to have a Paul Pierce night, but Isaiah Thomas, you know, staying out of it, and they're trying to figure out what that date is going to be whenever that happens sometime in early February. Well, then on NBA Countdown on ESPN earlier tonight, Paul Pierce had to deal with Jalen Rose saying, dude, you're being just a wee bit petty about this.
I got to say a word for you, fam. I thought it was petty.
Ooh. On who?
On Paul Pierce's part.
And what part?
I love Paul. This is my brother. Part? Because to me, there are going to be all type of announcements that happen the 48 minutes during that game.
Okay.
All types.
Okay.
Including celebrating Isaiah Thomas could be one of them. What does not take away from your situation like Kobe's that happened during the game, because they're doing yours post-game.
Okay, the petty thing was pretty funny. At least he said to a guy's face, he didn't hide behind a reporter, put it on Twitter. I'm not saying that Jalen Rose is wrong, because that could have worked out. Hey, it's still going to be your night, Paul Pierce. But the video tribute for an Isaiah Thomas, what he meant so much to that team and that city and vice versa. He never wanted to be traded in the first place. So you knew there were going to be that kind of feeling that was going to be there. But Myron, the Boston Celtics could have avoided this whole thing by picking another night for Paul Pierce after Isaiah Thomas's first return in a Cleveland Cavaliers uniform, even though he wasn't playing. They could have avoided this whole thing and not let it get to this point where friends are calling other friends petty if they had just picked another night to have Paul Pierce night for the Boston Celtics.
Yeah, and they should have done that. Like, I don't understand. I've never heard of two players being honored on the same night. Have you? Don't understand that.
No.
And to me, Paul Pierce deserves his own night. I mean, I'm from Milwaukee, grew up as a Milwaukee Bucks fan. Blue Edwards had a night, okay? I mean.
He did?
Guys who didn't deserve it had nights in Milwaukee. So for Paul Pierce, a guy who won a championship, a guy who did everything for that team on and off the court, he deserves his own night. I mean, I think it's simple, and you say, look, when do you want us to retire your jersey? When do you want us to give you this ceremony, Paul? Okay, that's Paul's night. So the idea that you want to squeeze in anything, especially with a guy who had just left in a trade and there was controversy and all the emotion, why would you want to stack that on top of a legend like Paul Pierce? I'm also curious, it's like, what does it take to get honored these days? Apparently not a ton, because it seems like anybody who leaves, if you go back, you're going to get a whole video montage. But I think Paul is right on this. He shouldn't have to share his night, his moment with anyone else. And that's not a personal thing against IT. It's about who he was to this team, what he brought to this team, and I think what he deserves in terms of being honored.
To your point, that's why the Boston Celtics as an organization could have avoided this whole thing. It's not, I hope it has not developed into a beef between Paul Pierce and Isaiah Thomas, because at that point I think, okay, that's just ridiculous, allowing this to really, not saying these guys were tight or that they were friends, but why create a divide that should not be there when all you had to do was to pick a different night outside of the night Isaiah Thomas is coming back? And I think it says so much to Isaiah Thomas that he wasn't there any length of time along the lines of Paul Pierce. Or even the late Reggie Lewis. Isaiah Thomas wasn't there as long as Reggie Lewis was there. And that's how much they think of him and still think of him and what he did for putting them back on the map, helping them become relevant again when they got him, Al Horford, Brad Stevens as a head coach. Danny Ainge did a great job making the Celtics relevant again. It could have been so much easier. It shouldn't be that hard to say, okay, if that night is not going to work, to avoid nonsense, let's move it to another night. Instead, the Celtics kept it there. They put it in the hands of Isaiah Thomas to say, look, I don't want this kind of stuff. And then Paul Pierce had to have people calling him petty because he just wants a night all to himself.
Yeah, I don't think he's wrong. I mean, I really don't. I think, you know, in today's society, the Celtics could have tweeted out a tribute video to IT if they wanted to. I mean, there were other ways to achieve this. I just don't understand. Everything feels so forced with this IT situation. Is it like they feel bad because he was so beloved and the people loved him, and at the end of the day, like, Paul Pierce did enough on his own to get a whole month in his honor. He won a championship. He's the reason KG and Ray Allen showed up.
Yeah.
He's the reason that Boston celebrated the way they did in 2008. And he was the guy who kept them alive and made them relevant for a longer period than Isaiah Thomas did. So I just think Paul Pierce is in that category of players where you see, look, Paul, how do you want to do this and win? And it's that simple. And instead, Boston couldn't get out of his own way. Danny Ainge, who's made a lot of great moves as the leader of that franchise, this was not one of them because this didn't have to happen.
Great stuff by Myron Metcalf along Freddie Coleman and Freddie Fitzsimmons on ESPN Radio. Real quick, when it comes to college basketball, it's been upset central tonight. SMU beat number 7 Wichita State 83-78. You also had, going down to defeat, was number 17 Auburn. Their 14-game winning streak out the window. Alabama beat them 76-71. Another Wednesday upset for Texas. They take down number 8 Texas Tech 67-58. But Texas Tech did a really cool thing. Andrew Jones, the Texas point guard, was recently diagnosed with leukemia last week. Texas Tech wore special warm-ups that had his number and his name on the back of their warm-ups, and they lined up, and the crowd gave them such a standing ovation, Myron. Well done by Texas Tech. I know the loss is not something they wanted, but honoring a player on another team by having the back of their warm-up shirts with his number and his name, and they lined up and got a standing ovation at Texas. Really cool by Chris Beard and his program to do something like that tonight.
That's a classy operation. That's a classy thing that Chris Beard did. Says a lot about who Andrew Jones is and how people are really supporting him.
Yeah, great stuff. Chris Beard and Texas Tech, bravo to you guys. I know you didn't want to lose that game, but you won in the game of life with that maneuver. The Super Bowl matchup you least want to see. That's next on ESPN Radio. Freddie Coleman and Myron Metcalf on Freddie and Fitzsimmons on ESPN Radio, the ESPN app, and Sirius XM Channel 80. Anytime a guest stops by to hang out with us and share that knowledge, they're here thanks to Shell Pennzoil Performance Line. Had a chance to check out these early Super Bowl lines. I know the championship weekend is here. We don't know who's going to be there in the Super Bowl. But according to some Vegas books, and as a matter of fact, I'm going to use this one, courtesy of Bovada.lv, here would be the odds, Myron, in the Super Bowl if these matchups happen, who would be favored. If you had Jaguars versus Eagles, the disrespect would continue for the Eagles. The Jaguars would be a 2.5-point favorite. If you had Patriots versus Eagles, the Patriots would be a 7-point favorite. If you had Patriots versus Vikings, the Patriots would be a 3-point favorite. And if you had Vikings versus Jaguars, the Jaguars would be a 5.5-point favorite. Now, before I get your sort of prediction of who you may like, who you're leaning towards, based on what I just gave you, through those lines out there, what would be the Super Bowl matchup you would least like to see?
Man, that's a good question. Philly, Jacksonville does nothing for me. Even though I'm really intrigued by Jacksonville and like what they've done, and I think they're the new kids on the block. Like the Eagles without Wentz, there's still just this element of like, man, what could be, right? Even if they beat Minnesota. So I don't know if I'd look forward to that matchup. But it's going to be interesting because I think you're going to have one of those in the NFC. You either have Foles or Case Keenum, sort of an unknown quarterback. So you're going to have to deal with that. But I think that doesn't do a whole lot for me, Jacksonville versus Philly.
Yeah, the one that would do the least for me would probably be Jacksonville versus Minnesota. And both of these stories are great. Think about this. Jacksonville last year, what were they, a 3-13 team? Yeah. And many people wonder about Tom Coughlin coming in to take over the organization. Okay, what's that old man going to do? He's just going to wreck the buffet and keep the buffet being wrecked and everything like that. And all of a sudden you turn around, they get Calais Campbell, they get Barry Church, they draft Leonard Fournette, they get those two corners, A.J. Bouye, they got him in free agency to go with Jalen Ramsey. And next thing you know, they are this rough and tumble football team that wind up winning their division and then taking advantage of Pittsburgh once again when a lot of people did not believe, and I'll raise my hand, that they would be able to do that for the second time this season. And then you have on the other side, the Minnesota Vikings. I can't remember, Myron, a 13-win team being this vanilla. And there's nothing wrong with vanilla. I like vanilla ice cream as much as the next person. As a matter of fact, it's my favorite ice cream. You give me some chocolate sprinkles, I'm good to go. But I can't remember a team this good in the regular season about to play for an NFC championship, and yet a lot of those guys could walk down the streets of America, and not one person would know that they play for the Minnesota Vikings. Case Keenum has been a terrific story. Kyle Rudolph, great personality. They're tied in. Harrison Smith, one of the best safeties in the National Football League. He's a quiet assassin. But usually you have a 13-3 team, there's always a one guy or one entity, something about that team you say, oh, man, I can't wait to see what's going to happen with so-and-so. You look at Minnesota, and a lot of people look and they go, wow, that team's in the Super Bowl? A lot of people just heard of Minnesota for the first time based on that Minnesota miracle that happened versus New Orleans, and still, a lot of people still do not know exactly who the best player is or what this team is all about.
Yeah, I mean, it's I think, indicative of, like, what's going on in the NFC. You know, yeah. This has not been a superstar year for the NFC. You're either going to be represented in the NFC by a team that doesn't have its starting quarterback. Foles has done, I mean, obviously he helped him get to this point, but he's been up and down. Or you're going to have an undrafted quarterback in Minnesota who's in the Super Bowl. Like, that rarely happens in the NFC, but that's what we're facing. I think Minnesota has a chance, if they put on a show Sunday against Philly, to really become, you know, maybe some of those guys step into the spotlight a little bit, whether it's Case Keenum and, you know, Linval Joseph and some of these other players they have, Adam Thielen. There's a chance to do that. But you're not going to override the reality that the AFC is going to make or break the Super Bowl one way or the other, whether it's New England and Tom Brady chasing another ring, or it's these young, you know, sort of energetic Jacksonville Jaguars. Like, the AFC, to me, will be the headliner. Even though Minnesota could be playing a Super Bowl in Minneapolis, right, in terms of competitiveness,
right,
the AFC is the headliner.
Yeah. Can you imagine if you got nothing against New England, because we know that the Patriots are going to ride that emotion in terms of they are the overall clear favorites to not only get to a Super Bowl, but to win a Super Bowl. Jacksonville is going to make it hard on them. A lot of people aren't buying the Jacksonville Jaguars that they're going to beat the New England Patriots. But where do you stand on that, Myron Metcalf, in terms of Jacksonville? Do they have a puncher's chance? Do you believe they're going to win? Or no chance of beating the Patriots on Sunday?
Oh, they got a chance. I mean, if you can go to Pittsburgh and do what they did twice, and with that defense, and, you know, people have said this. This isn't the first time, but how do you beat Tom Brady? Is very difficult, but you got to touch him somehow. And Saxonville has been able to do that throughout the season. So I think they definitely have a chance. Freddie, for me, Tom Brady is like no quarterback we've ever seen at this age.
Right.
But I remember when Brett Favre went from NFC Championship Brett Favre to a few months later coming back to the Vikings, and he had lost it. This thing can collapse at any time for Tom Brady. He can go from Tom Brady to
Greg
Tom
Brady,
the guy who looks 40, right? Yeah, right? Looks 40 years old all of a sudden. So I think Jacksonville has a chance.
Mm-hmm.
They were down 28-3 in the Super Bowl. Like, they should have lost in the Super Bowl. But Tom Brady's just that great.
Yeah.
They're not invincible.
Yeah, they're not invincible, but right now, when you think about it, not a watered-down NFL, but an NFL not as down as when Patriots winning championships before, all of a sudden this could be an easier path for the Patriots maybe to win that Super Bowl. Ted in Missouri, thanks for calling Freddie Coleman and Myron Metcalf on Freddie and Fitzsimmons at 888-SAY-ESPN. Ted, what you got, my friend?
Yeah, I would just like to know what y'all thought about Adrian Peterson sitting at home watching Minnesota possibly going to the Super Bowl.
You know what? This is the first time that someone has thought to mention that in terms of Adrian Peterson, because can you imagine? I don't know. I'm not going to put myself in his shoes. Hey, he's a grown man. He made a decision, or the Minnesota Vikings made it for him. However that happened, where that guy, one of the greatest players in the history of that organization, is no longer part of the Minnesota Vikings. I wonder how much buyer's remorse that he has along the lines of Tiki Barber with the New York Giants, who retired a year early. Then the next year they win the Super Bowl and beat the Patriots, who are 18-0. I wonder how much of Adrian Peterson is sitting back at home, Myron, going, man, oh, man, if I could have just kept it to myself and stayed there, I could be a part of a team and potentially going to a Super Bowl.
Yeah, I think if he stayed, though, he would have had to accept a reduced role. That's the problem. Like, to me, what this represents is the $10 million workhorse running back that defined the NFL for generations. That's over, right? If you can't be a versatile back and do a lot of different things, there's no room for you in the NFL. Like, the Vikings got much better and became a more versatile offense when they didn't hand the ball off to Adrian Peterson 30 times, because you got to build around a guy like that.
Right.
So I think that's what it is. I think this is a move away from the Adrian Petersons. Look at the teams right now. I mean, who has that kind of quarter running back? I mean, Leonard Fournette is kind of that workhorse. Obviously, had three touchdowns against Pittsburgh, but he hasn't been a 30 carry back every game for the Jacksonville Jaguars.
Those days are over.
Those days are definitely over, and I think that's why AP is sitting at home more than anything.
Shannon Penn, what you got?
All right, I don't remember this. I have to go back and look this up, but the Saints opened up the season this year at Minnesota.
With Adrian Peterson.
Did Adrian Peterson get a video tribute?
No, he didn't. I don't remember that.
No, he didn't. No. One of the reasons, Randy Moss was inducted to the Ring of Honor there that night. So maybe that has something to do with that.
And then they did not want him to infringe on Randy Moss having his night. See, the Boston Celtics could have done this, made it a lot easier for Paul Pierce and Isaiah Thomas, and Paul Pierce not getting called petty in a friendly natured way by Jalen Rose in NBA Countdown.
Yeah, he shouldn't have had to compete. Could you imagine Randy Moss having to compete with anybody? Randy wouldn't have liked that. And I get it. Like, you've worked hard enough to have your own day.
Yes. But I can't imagine you're Adrian Peterson, you're sitting at home, NFC Championship weekend. You got Case Keenum, the quarterback of the Minnesota Vikings, talking about feeling the need of stepping up as an underdog, how that feels.
I don't think in terms like that. I mean, are we proud of what we accomplished? You know, heck yeah. Do we have more out in front of us? Heck yeah. So what matters today is how we work, how we prepare today, and getting ready to beat the Eagles.
Meyer, that would be hard for me to shake. If I was in the shoes of Adrian Peterson and they're playing in the NFC Championship game, that would be hard for me to shake.
Yeah, I mean, there's obviously, I'm sure he has a feeling of, man, what could have been, but he wanted too much. And it wasn't just financial. He wanted to be the man, and this Vikings team is all about everybody plays their role. It's not about one star, and they're better because of it. I mean, AP leaving helped them.
Especially Case Keenum, who could be in line for a big payday one way or the other. Maybe he'll get some love from Mike Zimmer if they get to the Super Bowl, because his coach has not given him the love he deserves all season long. You can always follow us on Twitter. We have pretty good follows on Twitter, the 1-800-Flowers.com Twitter feed. Myron's handle at Metcalf by ESPN, my handle at Coleman ESPN. How much is Steph Curry still loved? These numbers back that up next on ESPN Radio. Freddie Coleman and Myron Metcalf on Freddie and Fitzsimmons, presented by Progressive Insurance on ESPN Radio, the ESPN app, and SiriusXM Channel 80. We'll talk about this no-name team that gets no love from you that comes your way in about 30 minutes. Now, Steph Curry gets plenty of love, whether you like it or not. He is going to be beloved, 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 period, end of story. This how much he is loved based according to the numbers. He is the NBA's most popular player when it comes to jersey sales. In the top 15 when it comes to jersey sales, Steph Curry is number one. LeBron James is number two. Kevin Durant's number three. Giannis Antetokounmpo, the Greek freak of Milwaukee, number four. Kristaps Porzingis of the New York Knicks, number five. Joel Embiid of the Sixers, number six. Russell Westbrook, OKC, number seven. Ben Simmons, 76ers, number eight. Kawhi Leonard of the Spurs, number nine. And James Harden of the Houston Rockets, number 10. 11 through 15 for you, Myron. Lonzo Ball of the Lakers. Kyrie Irving, number 12 of Boston. Klay Thompson, Golden State, number 13. Damian Lillard, number 14, the Portland Trail Blazers, and Jimmy Butler, the Minnesota Timberwolves, at number 15.
He is a superstar. I went to the Golden State Warriors game in Milwaukee on Friday last week, where I'm from.
Right.
And I stayed at a place near the arena, and I get to the lobby, and I was coming to the hotel. Nothing but kids and Steph Curry jerseys. I don't know where these Golden State fans came from in Milwaukee. Nothing but Steph Curry jerseys. So then I'm coming down, get ready to go to the game, and a dad has like three of his boys, all Steph Curry jerseys. Like, hey, you going to the game? Yeah, a little small talk.
Right.
I'm like, yeah, it's just too bad that Steph isn't playing tonight. And the look on his face and his kids' faces, I can tell, Freddie, that I had broken the news. They didn't know Steph wasn't playing that night.
Wow.
So the dad tried to massage a little bit. He was like, yeah, but he'll still be there. And I was like, yeah, he'll be around. Yeah, of course. But these kids look heartbroken. There were so many people around Steph, even though he was hurt, trying to get autographs, wearing his jerseys.
Right.
Like, he is the rock star. Like, he is Zach Morris to Kevin Durant's A.C. Slater, right? He is the show every time.
Did you just go Saved by the Bell on me?
Yes, did you? I did.
Yes, did you just I go did. Mark Paul Gosselaar, Mario Lopez did, on me?
I definitely did, and he is definitely Mark.
Third straight season, he's led the NBA in jersey sales, which is not surprising. Even seeing him tonight, they beat the Chicago Bulls. The Bulls fans were out of their minds, waiting for Golden State, hoping their team wins, or just seeing Steph Curry. He was signing autographs, so many autographs, before the game got started. And after the game, people holding out jerseys and everything, he stopped along the way before going to the locker room, Myron, and signed as much as he could before security said, "Hey, Steph, we can't wait any longer. You got to come with us so you get showered, meet the press, and do all those other kind of things." And when you, and I, here's one, this is another reason why I believe he'll never win another MVP, because of the popularity. No one saw this coming. You really don't see great players like this get to this level. There's always going to be a surprise. We knew LeBron James was going to be great. We didn't see this kind of greatness. Anybody says that, okay, fine. If that helps you sleep at night, go right ahead. But when it comes to Steph Curry, nobody saw this. And especially not only a one-time MVP, but a two-time MVP. Because of what he was able to accomplish out of Davidson, the way that he plays, the way that this style of play has revolutionized basketball. Everybody wants to play like Golden State. I wonder how much of that popularity, how much of that he enjoys and he has earned, may work against him, Myron, in winning another MVP, because somebody's going to say, well, Steph Curry's overachieved. Let's find somebody else who has more of a worthy cause or a worthy selection to be the MVP than him.
I mean, that sounds about right. You know, Michael Jordan, it was like everyone was always looking for someone else to give the MVP to, even though he deserved it. It might work against him, but I think he's enjoying every moment of this. Like, what I appreciate about Steph Curry is he's still the kid at Davidson who was overlooked, who didn't get the big-time scholarships, who didn't get the opportunities that other kids got, and had to really work for everything. And you still see that humility. It's not easy to invite a guy like Kevin Durant, who
right.
is one of the two best players in the world, I think, onto your roster and say, look, I'm a shooter. We already got another shooter in Klay Thompson. But, yeah, come aboard. If I have to play a reduced role, that's cool. Like, to me, that is a guy who knows how to humble himself and doesn't have an ego, because I don't know if there's another superstar in the league who would have been cool with that. It didn't work in Oklahoma City with Russ, no. And now you're bringing a guy like that. That, to me, is the biggest thing about Steph Curry that will ultimately define his legacy, is this guy brought in another superstar, and he didn't have a problem with it, and they just got better because the dude just wants to win. And I think that's what he's all about more than any of the other accolades, and that's what people appreciate about him.
An alpha dog who didn't mind another alpha dog joining forces with him and subjugating their egos. So far, so good. Golden State last year, by the way, they won tonight, their 14th straight road win. Myron Metcalf and Freddie Coleman of Freddie and Fitzsimmons on ESPN Radio. In case you missed the news earlier tonight, suspensions were handed down in the NBA from that Clippers-Rockets brouhaha, but not on Chris Paul. Nope. Not on James Harden. Uh-uh. Not on Blake Griffin. Forget it. Gerald Green and Trevor Ariza suspended two games each. Adrian Wojnarowski, when he was on SportsCenter as an ESPN NBA insider, explains exactly why the NBA decided those two got suspended and not the other three.
What went into this disciplinary process? I understand you just talked to Kiki Vandeweghe not long ago.
I did, guys. And talking to Kiki Vandeweghe from the league office, they did interviews with over 20 people involved in this, from players, team officials, security, and came away with an assessment that Chris Paul and James Harden had acted as peacemakers, that their verbiage around Ariza and Green going into the locker room was about trying to slow them down, get those two out. But the two-game suspension for Green and Ariza was centered around them aggressively entering the Clipper locker room, looking for a verbal, at the very least, a verbal altercation with Austin Rivers. And essentially, the league decided it is, you know, as Vandeweghe said, it's unacceptable. It's a potentially dangerous situation to have a player go right from the court into another team's locker room. There's also no penalties for the Clippers' Blake Griffin. The league did look at his bump or his brush with Mike D'Antoni during the game and concluded that D'Antoni, that it wasn't intentional. That D'Antoni, you know, certainly the heat of an intensely contested game, and they gave, you know, no penalties beyond Ariza and Gerald Green, who get the two-game suspension now.
There was no way in God's graces that Adam Silver was going to suspend James Harden, Chris Paul, and Blake Griffin. Although, to me, Myron, they interviewed 20 people in less than 48 hours. We need that kind of investigation team in our government, not just working for the NBA, my friend.
Yeah, that's Dateline, and that's like a 48 hours mystery kind of thing. But Blake Griffin can obviously make contact with an NBA head coach. Nothing happens.
Mm-hmm.
Gerald Green thinks about making contact with an opposing player in the locker room, and he misses two games. I think we all understand what happened in this situation.
What is it called? Pecking order?
Pecking order is definitely real.
Yeah, and if you're Chris Paul, and Chris Paul once again, start something, instigate something. They had a video tribute for him before the game, first game back against the Clippers in a Rockets uniform, and then when everything jumped off, the next thing you knew, the two guys that were lesser names, they bore the brunt of it. And, oh, by the way, Houston's playing Golden State on Saturday, national television, ABC. There was no way Adam Silver was suspending Chris Paul and James Harden for two games and let them miss that. No way, no how. How much are you rooting for the Jacksonville Jaguars? That's next on ESPN Radio, the ESPN app, and Sirius XM Channel 80.
This is Freddie and Fitzsimmons
Showtime
on ESPN Radio.
And on the ESPN app.
What is good, y'all? Thanks for joining Freddie Coleman and Myron Metcalf and Freddie Fitzsimmons, presented by Progressive Insurance on the ESPN app and Sirius XM Channel 80, in case you missed out. It is championship weekend this weekend in the National Football League. Don't worry about the ratings. That's the network's problem. That's not our problem. Let's worry about football this weekend. You got New England and Jacksonville on one side in the AFC Championship game, and Minnesota versus Philadelphia on the other side in the NFC Championship game. How many of you are rooting for Jacksonville against Tom Brady? 888-SAY-ESPN, 888-729-3776, because, Myron, we know that the Patriots are America's team, but they can also be America's villain, especially when they won time and time and time and time again. I don't have a dog in the fight. I don't care who wins. I'm not rooting against Tom Brady. I'm not hoping that they lose, and as a Jets fan, to be morally opposed to what they're doing. But I wonder how many people out there, casual football fans or hardcore football fans, are saying, Jacksonville, please do us a solid and make Tom Brady and his wife cry so they don't win a championship.
I'm trying to find a reason. Like, if you're a casual fan or even an invested fan and you're not a New England Patriots diehard, how can you not root for this Jacksonville team? Their quarterback is a dude named Blake Bortles from Central Florida. Leonard Fournette. I mean, they got all these young guys who are really playing above their potential, what people deem to be their potential.
Right.
They're talking trash. They're daring people to beat them. They just went to Pittsburgh and won for the second time this season. A lot of people thought Buffalo was going to Did they play Buffalo in the first round? Who did they play in the first
Jackson
round?
Jackson played Buffalo 10-3.
Buffalo, right? So a lot of people thought Buffalo's going to come in and beat them. But here they are playing a New England Patriots team and having a shot to go to the Super Bowl. I think Jacksonville has become the most likable team remaining in these playoffs. When you look at their youth, being the underdog, and just continuing to find ways with that defense, how do you not root for Jacksonville, especially when they're playing the Patriots?
Well, Blake Bortles, whether he's been criticized so much, has gotten to the point that I'm surprised not a hashtag beat up on Blake Bortles, because even when they have not played his team, they've had something nasty to say about him. But as far as he's concerned, with Tom Brady on the other side playing in the AFC Championship game, he's going to savor every last second of this moment.
Personally, you know, I don't care. I look at it as, you know, it's an incredible opportunity to continue to be able to play football at this time of year. And I think it's pretty awesome and special to be able to, you know, share this with the group of guys we got in that locker room, because I think everybody knows it's not going to be the same group next year. You know, guys can go at any time. So I think to kind of enjoy, you know, continuing to play football, obviously, you know, for the longest that we have in a long time, and enjoy it with these guys every single day. You know, we're one of four teams that gets to come out and practice, you know, on a Wednesday today, and that's special. I mean, it's something that everybody dreams of, and it's something that everybody works towards. So for us to be able to be here and be in this position, it's pretty awesome.
I don't know how much it is that people are rooting for the story that is Jacksonville, or the hate that they have in the Patriots. Already people blowing up my timeline on Twitter, Coleman ESPN, about how much you're rooting for the Jacksonville Jaguars versus New England. Fritz says, yes, they beat my at Steelers, and no way I'll ever root for New England. Reverend Ned Horse Cheese, great handle, by the way, says, all of us, man. All of us. And when you win, and you win like they have, there's inevitably going to be somebody say, all right, enough of them. Can we have somebody else?
Yeah, it is. To me, this Jacksonville team is the perfect team that's playing with no pressure. Mm-hmm. Like, that's what I love. They're playing with such a free spirit right now. All these young guys and how aggressive they are. And I think that's what you saw on Sunday against Pittsburgh. Pittsburgh was timid initially. They were tight. And you had these young guys who were just jumping routes and really just believing that they could win that game. And that energy, I think, is infectious. And you got to root for the Jaguars, mm-hmm. I think, Sunday, unless you're a New England diehard. They got a lot of bandwagon fans, too. So unless you're one of them. But everybody else should be rooting for Jacksonville.
Wow. And Scott in Illinois, thanks for calling Freddie Coleman and Meyer Metcalf on Freddie Fitzsimmons at 888-729-3776. Scott, how much are you rooting for Jacksonville to beat New England on Sunday?
You are spot on. I am so hoping that Jacksonville does take care of business. I think this garbage that whatever Tom Brady's hands hurt today, that's a bunch of baloney. Belichick's little games. Come on. And another thing, I want to tell you something else, Freddie. You got the best show on ESPN. Hands down. I wake you every day to listen to you this time of night. Every day.
Scott in Illinois, I really appreciate those kind words. And believe me, I stand on the shoulders of listeners. We all do. There's no us without you guys out there. So thank you for those kind words, number one. And number two, the whole give me the Tom Brady thing when they said he was on the injury report. And when I saw that he didn't want to talk to the media because he has a hand injury, I said, Tom said, hey, Bill, can I wait till tomorrow? Bill said, sure, why not? You don't have to talk to the media today. It's only Wednesday. Yeah, wink, wink, nudge, nudge, Myron. He didn't want to talk to the media. I'm okay with that. Hey, rest your hand, whatever happened, whatever that is. The media is going to be fine. They're going to be there waiting for him tomorrow.
Yeah, they'll show up. He won't have any problem finding the cameras. They'll find him.
Whether he wants them to or not.
Yeah, they're gonna find him.
Truck is Sean in St. Louis. Rooting for the Jags or the Patriots, and why?
I'm going for Jacksonville. New England's going to win, but I took, I had to take Fitz's advice. I bet to my hands bleed. I'm taking Jacksonville in the point spread.
Ooh, I like
that. For all your listeners, that last listener, yes, true, I call you all the time. You are the best out here. And but all you listeners that are freezing, I just ran over Jack Frost. And he said, they're sad, a warm front's coming. So God bless America, and keep America going, baby.
That's what I love about people this time of night.
Not your saying show other is people, amazing,
yeah,
man.
Not saying other people aren't genuine throughout other day parts, whether it's ESPN radio, other national shows, but the night people, they keep us going because they keep America working so everybody else on the other side of the night can get it going. But in terms of that, I mean, that's what I love about the Patriots, what they've been able to do, I give them plenty of respect. And yeah, you can mention Spygate, you can mention Deflategate, you can mention Bill Belichick and Tom Brady and this and this. But when you've gotten to a level that they've gotten at, they want all of that. They want people coming at them, Meyer. They love the bullets and arrows that are being thrown at them. And if you're the National Football League, anytime you have that kind of star power, that aura about you, that is always going to work. I call Tom Brady Captain America. I've called him that for a minute. And yeah, the Dallas Cowboys still America's team. More eyeballs will watch them. But I don't know how close the Patriots are to that, Myron, in terms of attention, no matter where they're playing. But believe me, plenty of people are looking to see if they're going to continue this run or if Jacksonville can pull the upset. Either way, that's a good thing for the NFL this weekend.
Oh, they want this controversy for sure. The Patriots being involved is a great thing one way or the other. For the NFL, definitely.
Chris in Colorado, Jacksonville or New England, who are you rooting for this Sunday and why?
That's not even a question. We're going Jacksonville. I was in a bar this past weekend watching the game against the Steelers. My roommate's a Steelers fan. I, of course, took the Jags with the spread. And he had a few rounds of drinks bought with that winnings because, man, that was a good time. I think everybody in the bar was rooting for the Jags, too, which I found weird because Steelers have a pretty good following. So I think this week against the Patriots, no question, Jacksonville's going to be America's favorite team all of a sudden.
Wow.
And a little love for my man Nick Foles. Let's go Philadelphia. Fly, Eagles, fly.
Nothing wrong with that, giving love to Nick Foles, because Lord knows he didn't get plenty of love the week before when they played the Atlanta Falcons. Shannon Penn, what were you saying about all this love for Jacksonville right now?
And I noticed this, and Chris brought it up. Everyone's referring to Jacksonville as we at this point. We are rooting for Jacksonville. Jacksonville has become us.
It's like a we versus they. It's like, them versus us.
That's like you win the lottery and your cousin's like, no, we won the lottery.
Yeah, and then you said, we is yes in French. Yeah. I won the lottery. Not we won the lottery. And the Pages love everything about this. But if you're Jacksonville, I love what Blake Bortles said. Hey, we're going to savor this moment. Last year, we were a 3-13 team. Many people did not even believe that we were going to be in this position. And Myron, I wonder how much of that could allow, I don't want to say experts or analysts or whatever. I wonder how much of that love, as I put that in air quotes, could lead people to say, you know what, Jacksonville is going to pull this upset. Maybe we should give them more of a chance to beat the Patriots than actually people are giving this Jacksonville football team.
Yeah, I mean, if you look at the numbers and you look at how aggressive this defense is, you know, I'm not sure how anybody's looking at the numbers and going that they don't have a chance. Defense is nasty. They got big, strong corners who attack. They have a great defensive line. They come at you. They even when they don't get sacks, they rough you up. I mean, that's the thing. They're a very aggressive defense. And Blake Bortles has been enough, and Fournette has been enough to help them win games. I think people might be surprised how well they play on Sunday. They have a real chance, this young, vibrant team, to pull off an upset.
William Dean hit me on Twitter saying, can we get an AFC Championship sack record-breaking performance to knock out the Patriots? Hashtag dream come true. Keep weighing in on Twitter at ColemanESPN. That is my handle. Also at ESPN Radio. And can't forget about my man Myron Metcalf at Metcalf by ESPN, part of the 1-800-Flowers.com Twitter feed. Finally, this word can be attached and should be attached to the Minnesota Vikings. We'll tell you that word next on ESPN Radio and the ESPN app. It's your thing. Do what you want to do. Freddie Fitzsimmons with Freddie Coleman and Maya Metcalf on ESPN Radio, the ESPN app, and Sirius XM Channel 80. We'll get to the word that can and should be attached to the Minnesota Vikings finally for the first time all year. That comes your way in a second. But real quick, Billy in Philly hitting us up at 888-SAY-ESPN. Billy in Philly, what you got, my friend?
Billy from Philly, by the way, but great show, guys, by
the
way.
Thank you.
So I got two things to say. One, yes, Jacksonville, go. Please go. I'm done with this New England stuff, and honestly, that defense has the opportunity to beat Tom Brady if they do it right today, Sunday, sorry. Mm-hmm. But, yeah, I'm going to the NFC Championship game, and I'm stoked. I've never done a playoff game before, so, Yeah, old college friend got me there. And I feel like the only problem I have is Case Keenum might run away from our rush, which worries me. But I think that Nick Foles can do it because now he's got some confidence. And I think our D-line will take care of that quarterback.
Wow. Billy from Philly broke it down quite nicely. Thank you very much. By the way, enjoy the NFC Championship game. You get a chance to go there and do that. Man, that is an experience that not a lot of people get a chance. And speaking of Nick Foles, even Lane Johnson, Eagles offensive lineman, Ogolek and Wingo said that bruh's getting more comfortable.
I think what we've done is able to put him in a comfortable situation over the past, you know, this past game and get the right game plan for him. And, let him play with confidence to be who he is. I mean, nothing really changed with him. I mean, as far as confidence, I mean, I've never seen Nick get shaken in a game or in a huddle. And, you know, that's probably never going to change.
Okay, so that's fantastic that Lane Johnson, like, look, y'all can say what you want, but we know what he's going to be able to do, and he's been able to raise his level, and we're going to raise our level as well. But the Minnesota Vikings, Myron, are still a favorite in this game. And I think for the first time all year, the word pressure can be put on this no-name team because they are this close to doing something that has never been done in the National Football League, a team playing in the Super Bowl on their home field. That is what is there for the Minnesota Vikings. Yeah, they'll try to downplay, they'll try to soft shoe it, but they know that it's there, that it's never happened. And having that kind of home field advantage would be completely invaluable. It's something that's a new territory if that's going to happen in the National Football League. Being a favorite with that defense, the Minnesota miracle that happened, they were able to snatch victory out of the jaws of defeat with the Minnesota Vikings for the first time all year, Myron, the word pressure can and should be attached to the Minnesota Vikings.
Yeah, I mean, it gets real now. I mean, they obviously face pressure against New Orleans last Sunday in the final 10 seconds, but I honestly think, Freddie, that there's more pressure on the Vikings going into this game than being in the Super Bowl in Minneapolis. If they get to the Super Bowl in Minneapolis, they're either going to face a Tom Brady-led Patriots team looking for another ring, mm-hmm. and they'll be the underdogs, or they're going to have to play this young, energetic Jacksonville team that just went through Buffalo on the road at Pitt and on the road at New England and emerged as the representative in the AFC. I don't think anyone would make a big deal of them losing in a game like that. But if you go to Philly and you have a chance to beat a Philly team without Carson Wentz and then go home and play in the Super Bowl, I think that's something that'll stick with them forever. I think Minnesota has gone through the process that Philly's still going through, right, adjusting with Nick Foles, getting more comfortable. Minnesota went through that when Sam Bradford got hurt early in the season and they transitioned to Case Keenum. I think this is just a confident group, and a lot of people don't know Adam Thielen and Stephon Diggs and all the other players on this roster, but that's what the NFC Championship, I think, can do for this team, is really show people how good they are. But pressure is real, but I think it's more real in this game than actually it will be if they go to a Super Bowl and they play in Minneapolis, given the opponent they would have to go through to complete that fantasy.
I'm always going to be a big believer that when you have a chance to win a world championship, there's more pressure to do that than to win an NFC championship, especially the Minnesota Vikings, and having it on your home field. Even if Tom Brady is on the other side, can you imagine what that celebration would be if you're able to play on your home field and win on your home field, especially if Tom Brady is on the other side, or even if Jacksonville is on the other side? I also wanted this about pressure with the Minnesota Vikings. How much will how will they get away from the Minnesota miracle? Because even Case Keenum, even on Wednesday, we're 3 days removed from that. Even on Wednesday, he was being asked about it and answering it this way about how that game, that moment, has benefited him.
You know, it's another experience, and it was my first playoff experience, and you know, it's something that I've said all year that I learn from every experience that I'm in, and I definitely learned a lot from that. I learned a lot from the emotions I felt, to how I handled it, to how I prepared, and something that I applied this week, and I'm continuing to apply to this next game.
Their minds are still back there on Sunday, even though their bodies are getting ready for the NFC Championship game, because when you have a singular moment like that, and let's call it as it is, that is the most singular moment in the history of that Minnesota Vikings franchise, a proud and storied franchise that has not won a Super Bowl, but they've been there more than a couple of times, although they have not been there in a long, long time. When you have something that was like a meteor coming out of nowhere, when people thought you were going to lose that game, that you were not going to find a way to win, you can say all the right things, and Case Keenum said all the right things, Myron, but your mind is one place, your body's in a different place. And if you're Mike Zimmer, you got to do everything you can to make sure your team knows, hey, that was great, but we still got a championship to play for. We got to go on the road to do it.
Yeah, and I'm sure Zimmer's probably doing that as early as the following day. But you're right. If you're Case Keenum, you know you're one throw away from being the villain, right? If he doesn't make that throw and complete that throw, he's the guy who messed it all up in the previous quarter and, you know, is the reason that Minnesota didn't win. But he throws a miraculous pass, and everything works for the Vikings. They can't rely on that. And if anything, Zimmer's sending them into this week going, look, we were a play away from losing a game in which we had a 17-0 lead. If we go to Philly and do that, we're not coming out with a victory. So I think this team understands its margin for error is not very vast at this point. And they got to make the right plays throughout the game, and they got to play strong on the road in the fourth quarter. So I don't think they're overconfident at all. I think they know that was a miracle, but you don't get two of them usually in the playoffs.
No.
So they got to find a way to execute from beginning to end if they want a chance to go back to the Super Bowl in their hometown.
One of the things about a game like this, where when you think about it, Jacksonville, Philadelphia, there's still unknown quantities to a lot of the casual fans out there. I wonder how much of the curiosity factor may take over people to take a look-see, and they'll like what they're going to see, and then keep watching the game. I want to see exactly how that's going to shake out, Myron, when both of these two get together playing the NFC Championship game, Vikings and Eagles on one side, that's the late game, and the early game, the AFC Championship game, the New England Patriots taking on the Jacksonville Jaguars. Jacksonville beat Pittsburgh. Pittsburgh fired their offensive coordinator. How much of a scapegoat is Todd Haley? That's next.
You can be mad at me. Tell me I was born to quit. I was checking. Go on. Or you could just freak with me. Set it again. Let the numbers roll.
Freddie coming to my Metcalf. I'm Freddie Fitzsimmons, presented by Progressive Insurance and the ESPN app, ESPN Radio, and Sirius XM Channel 80. Always good to talk to somebody who is not only well-versed in the NFL, but also well-versed in the NBA. The terrific Jordan Schultz, Yahoo Sports Insider, is here thanks to Shell Pinto Performance Line. Jordan, I'm going to start with this. When I say Todd Haley was made a scapegoat being fired as offensive coordinator by the Pittsburgh Steelers, what do you say?
Freddie, you're absolutely right. You know, this is one of the best offenses in the league the past several years, and he's done it, you know, with different personnel from the running back position when Le'Veon Bell has been out. He's done it with Ben struggling. They found a way to consistently keep the identity, you know, play action, run the ball, and they're creative. It's not perfect with Todd Haley, and there's certainly been issues with him developing and really getting worse, obviously, with Ben. And I just look at the Steelers, and it's like, what else would you want from this guy? You know, their defense has been up and down. They were really good before Shazier got hurt. But, you know, they put up 40 against Jacksonville, or whatever it was, and had an opportunity to win that game when the defense got shredded. And, you know, they have really good personnel, but I think absolutely Todd Haley has made the scapegoat, and it won't be long before he gets another opportunity.
Jordan, obviously this aggressive Jacksonville defense, Saxonville, do they have sort of the personnel and the strategy to disrupt Tom Brady and really make a game of a Sunday?
Yeah, I think they do. You know, Jacksonville is interesting because they have so much team speed. On defense, they can get after you, obviously, number one in the league in sacks. But, you know, you saw it against Pittsburgh, whether it was Jalen Ramsey, Smith, you know, they can get after you in a lot of different ways. And I think Calais Campbell, you know, he's had this great year. But that whole line has been really good. And they've been built, you know, from the inside out. And they're not entirely dissimilar to what Seattle had a few years ago when they were in elite defense. You know, really good line, great fast linebackers, good cover guys. You know, A.J. Boye has been fantastic. So, you know, it's a matter of, like, can they disrupt Tom Brady enough? Can they hit him enough? And I think they can. I don't know if they have enough firepower offensively to keep up with them, because at some point New England's going to score points at home. You know, they haven't lost a home game in the playoffs in since 2012, so it's only a matter of time. But I do believe the defense is good enough to win that game, yeah.
How much do you think New England could miss a Julian Edelman in a game like this?
Well, he's big because, you know, he's the one that works the middle of the field. And when you think about New England, you know, we talk a lot about Gronk, but the middle of the field is so important for them, and he's what ultimately, and this is what not having him all year has hurt Brandon Cooks to a degree. He's what ultimately allows everything else to operate, you know, a 100-catch guy. So, you know, Amendola has been up and down for them. You know, Hogan has been up and down. Cooks has been really good. But I think Edelman, this is a perfect game that he would have played because, you know, on those third and five, those third and seven, the third and mediums, you know, he's really their go-to guy, and he has been the past several years. But, you know, they've done it all year without him, so it's only a matter of time with that aspect that they are able to convert on third down as well.
Case Keenum saved this franchise, this Minnesota team, after Bradford goes down, exceeds all expectations. Are we at the point where the Vikings should write the check, whatever he demands, or do you let him go because he's going to ask for too much? I mean, what do they do with him?
Well, I think if you think about what he's done, to your point, that's, you know, he was supposed to be this Band-Aid, and he's been much more than that. You know, when Bradford went out, I think a lot of people wrote Minnesota off. Keenum had a really good year. You know, not like the Tom Brady kind of year, but that's not what they needed from him. They just need him not to turn the ball over, make enough throws, be smart, and really rely on that defense in the running game. And remember, they lost Dalvin Cook early. But I think they still believe that Teddy Bridgewater is the future. And, you know, they've invested in him. Obviously, you know, it's been a long way back, and we don't know if he'll ever be 100%. But I do believe that when it comes down to it, unless they win a Super Bowl, which I don't think they will, but it is possible. But I do think Bridgewater still is the guy there, and I think they believe he is. But Keenum's been way more than they thought, and I think even the biggest Vikings fans have been surprised, pleasantly surprised by what he's given them.
Jordan Schultz, Yahoo Sports Insider with Freddie Coleman and Myron Metcalf on Freddie and Fitzsimmons. Speaking of surprises, Nick Foles, boy, he surprised everybody the way he played from the second quarter on versus the Philadelphia Eagles. But he's going to go against the Vikings defense that, I swear, if you tried to take you try to get a first down on them, they really take it personally. We saw what he was able to do with those RPOs, those run-pass options. How much of that will Philadelphia need to start with and not wait until the second quarter to get him going?
Really soon. I mean, you know, Philadelphia, like, I'm just not convinced, guys, that their defense is where it was, you know, week 12 or week 11 before Wentz got hurt. And if you think about third down defense, Minnesota is number one in the league, and it's not even close. Philadelphia is third. So, you know, that defense is still very good. I just don't think it's at the same level. You know, when Nick Foles played his first game after being out a year and a half, week 15 against the Giants, he had four touchdowns, no picks. He looked great. He was moving well. Then he had a couple bad weeks. And then last week, to your point, Freddie, with the RPOs and, you know, they've really kept everything the same for him. It's not that much different than what they had with Carson Wentz. You know, it's very similar concepts, college concepts, a lot of stack formation, simple reads, and he's accurate to a degree. So, you know, I think with Wentz or with Foles, they got to get him in a rhythm early, more so than Keenum. I mean, Keenum's 12-3 as a starter with 16 touchdowns over that span. You know, Foles hasn't really played a lot of football the last year and a half, so he needs to get going early to feel confident. But they also, in Philadelphia, they really need to run the ball in this game, and I don't know if they're going to have the success on the ground.
Jordan, where does Kirk Cousins end up next season?
Well, you know, this thing moves every day, it seems like. He's going to get big-time money. You know, he's 29 years old. He's not in that top tier, but I think most people around the league would consider him, you know, in that second tier of quarterbacks, somewhere along the Alex Smith but range. But if I had to guess right now, I would say he still ends up in Washington. I just don't see them moving on from him. But he wants to get paid, and somebody's going to pay him if it's not Washington.
Great stuff by Jordan Schultz on Yahoo Sports with Freddie coming to Myron Metcalf on ESPN Radio's Freddie and Fitzsimmons. Switching gears to the NBA, Gerald Green gets two games. Trevor Ariza gets two games to Houston Rockets. Yet Andy Dufresne, I mean Chris Paul, no games. You had also James Harden, no games. And Blake Griffin, no games for their suspensions or no suspensions. And what happened on Monday? What was up with the NBA when Chris Paul instigated a lot of this, but yet he gets off scot-free, Jordan?
Yeah, this was a little strange to me. First of all, Chris Paul has a, like many guys, a pretty strained relationship with Austin Rivers. And there's two reasons why, and then we'll get to the suspension or lack thereof. One is that when he was in L.A., or when, you know, he still is in L.A., but the whole perception around Rivers was that he acted like a superstar because his dad was the coach, and he kind of did what he wanted. And then what really killed the relationship, and this is with Blake, too, to a degree, they had an opportunity to get Carmelo Anthony, and Doc didn't want to do it because he didn't want to trade his son. And, you know, all of that has really festered. I'm surprised with Chris Paul, though. I didn't get it. And, you know, him escaping from that is just strange. Like, there's no other way to describe it. You know, he's just as much at fault as Ariza and anybody else. And it was just weird. I really don't have a real explanation other than the fact that it was shocking.
When you look at the Minnesota Timberwolves, what do you like about that team? And what are some of your concerns?
You know, I think Minnesota, they have on paper everything you want. Great big man who can really pass in Carl Anthony. Flashing guy in Andrew Wiggins, whose numbers are down, shooting is down, scoring is down, but he's also taking less shots. You know, closer, elite closer, two-way guy in Jimmy Butler. But from a perspective of defensively, they have lulls, but they play really hard. And it's almost like, with Tom Thibodeau, there is a perception that he really wears guys down, that guys get tired of hearing the same message. And that's probably too true to a degree. But for a young team, the way they defend is admirable. My concern with them is, A, do they have enough shooting? And B, do they have enough of a depth? Like, do they have 8-9 guys? Because if you look at them, they really only play seven and a half, if you will. And that's, in the playoffs, you know, you need depth. And you know, Thibodeau has really shortened that rotation, and that concerns me as well. But, you know, and then they have Jeff Teague, who's just really a solid top eight, top 10 point guard. So there's a lot to like there, but they're really young. The West is really tough. And they're in, you know, basically inexperienced in the playoffs almost across the board.
He is a great follow on Twitter at Schultz_report. The former college two guard known as Jordan Schultz from Yahoo.
Barely,
Sports Inside.
Barely.
Not barely. You could probably knock down a three or two. Don't be sandbagging on us, Jordan. Great to hear him as he joined us here on ESPN Radio's Freddie and Fitzsimmons. Jordan, always a pleasure, my friend. We'll do it again soon, okay?
Guys, my pleasure. Thank you.
Absolutely. Thanks. By the way, if you missed our conversation with Jordan Schultz, Yahoo Sports Insider, subscribe to the podcast in the Listen tab of the ESPN app, Apple Podcasts, as well as TuneIn. Time for you to tune in to get your frenzy on. Make it the best 15 seconds of your day at 888-SAY-ESPN, 888-729-3776. Whatever is on your mind in the world of sports, we want to hear from you at 888-729-3776. But you try to go beyond 15 seconds. That's what'll happen. Don't make us do that to you. Be a part of the frenzy right now on ESPN Radio. Freddie Coleman and Myron Metcalf on Freddie and Fitzsimmons, presented by Progressive Insurance on ESPN Radio, the ESPN app, and Sirius XM Channel 80. Big thanks to Jordan Schultz of Yahoo Sports. As an insider, was terrific. He was here. Thanks to Shell Penzo, performance line about 5 minutes ago. He had his time. It is your time right now. Be a part of the frenzy at 888-SAY-ESPN, 888-729-3776. Our man Stosh will handle the tracks. You bring the funk and the facts. We'll put it together. It's going to be a good frenzy. Thank you very much. The Right Reverend Tim in Illinois. Tim, kick off the frenzy.
Here we go. Case Keenum, Nick Foles, one common denominator, Jeff Fisher. You better vote for Steve McNair for the Hall of Fame.
Think about this. Three guys that are part of Championship Weekend, as he mentioned, two of them, Nick Foles and Case Keenum, yes. Part of Championship Weekend. Jeff Fisher could not get the best out of those guys when he had them. And yet Jeff Fisher, mine was always talked about, this guy's one of the best coaches in the NFL. I said, I guess 7-9 must be the low bar for being one of the best coaches in the NFL.
Yeah, nobody lived off of one great season longer than Jeff Fisher did.
Yeah, I mean, not hating on somebody. If you can do that, if it's good work, if you can get it. But boy, oh boy, that would just make my eyes bleed all the time every time I would hear that. Nothing personal, Jeff. I'm just going by the facts of the matter and how people put you in that category. I'm not saying, I'm just saying. Darnell in Rochester, what you got for the frenzy?
All right, two things here. Jacksonville is going down against New England, mm-hmm. and Stephen Curry leading the league in jersey sales proves that everyone loves a one-trick pony that does nothing but shoot threes. Thank you.
Well, Steph Curry has also averaged over 8 assists a couple of times in his NBA career. He's been a 2-time MVP, and by the way, he has 2 championship rings. We should all be a one-trick pony like that in our profession.
And he's a lot more than that. He's a creator. He's Allen Iverson who can shoot threes. I mean, he's one of the more dynamic players we've ever seen.
And by the way, he doesn't shoot his team out of a game.
No. He's great. Like, come on. How can you say one-trick pony? Come on, man.
That must be Russell Westbrook's brother up in Rochester. That's the only thing I can think of. And I'm a Russell Westbrook fan as well. But Steph Curry, a one-trick pony? If that helps you sleep at night, okay.
He'd want him. If Steph Curry was available, his favorite team had a spot.
Yeah, I'm a Knicks fan. Give me Seth Curry for my Knicks. Exactly. I'd take him
I'll take Dale. Milwaukee, you can add Dale. We'll take any of the Currys.
Absolutely, man. Dale Curry could probably still get you 10. Let him spot up and wait for you. Even Mama Curry might get you 8 on the Knicks if she's open.
They'd run you out of the gym, I bet. They show up on pickup games on Saturday
Yeah.
morning.
Steph Curry, a one-trick pony. The more I know, the less I understand.
Stop.
Josh in Phoenix, what you got for the frenzy?
Hey, thanks for taking my call. Love the show.
Thank you.
First off, Jacksonville Eagles Super Bowl, Jacksonville by 4. U.S. Women's Gymnastics, no words can describe how we should be feeling, but we should be feeling horrible. And Jeff Fisher, 7-9, was talking about the two quarterbacks he wasn't going to be using. Haterade drinking in the NBA is coming from the 70s or the 80s.
He tried to fit that last one in there, but yeah, that wasn't going to work. But I look at it, when USA Gymnastics, it seems that every time I read something about that, Myron, I'm just continuing to be more disgusted. completely disgusted. And I go. It goes back to what I said last night, earlier tonight. It should not be that hard to do the right thing when somebody's being wronged.
It shouldn't. I hope you almost have to rebuild the system and create more accountability so that stuff like this can't happen. That's what you hope comes out of this, but it won't replace the scars that these victims have already endured.
Yeah, I'll go back to that one young lady whose dad did not believe her. Yeah. And then when everything came about and he realized his daughter was telling the truth, he wound up committing suicide. That's always going to stick and burn with me because of somebody else who did that to his child.
Yeah, a lot of enablers.
Yeah, one enabler is one too many, as far as I'm concerned. Adam and Riley, thanks for calling the Frenzy at 888, say ESPN. What you got for Freddie and Myron?
Well, first off, I want to say thanks for taking my call. Second off, with Monty Jones saying it'd be the worst Super Bowl without Tom Brady, I don't agree. Jacksonville was 30-13 last year. That's a huge story. Case Keenum, third string quarterback to Teddy Bridgewater and Sam Bradford. And Nick Foles, a quarterback who almost retired, came back and might win as a backup. That's a pretty big Super Bowl without Tom.
He almost got it in with that last point, but those are great stories, seriously. But in the age we live in, Myron, if it's not something that sizzles immediately, a lot of people look for something else. The NFL is no different.
Play the hits. People want to see Tom Brady just like they want to see LeBron. Whether you love him or you hate him, they are sort of one of the key players. So you want Tom Brady in the Super Bowl if you're the NFL.
Oh, yeah.
It'd be interesting to see what would happen if Jacksonville and Minnesota made it.
Yeah, well, you put it that way. You got to sell the game. It's a social event. You can't just slight them because Captain America's not a part of it. You can't be doing that. That's just rude, and quite frankly, I find it ugly. Adam and Raleigh, what you got for the Frenzy? Oh, I'm sorry. Dan in St. Louis, what you got for the Frenzy?
Oh, yeah, this is Dan, man. I was just calling to say, if it's okay to have a knockdown drag out in hockey, why is it you acting like a thug if you fighting in basketball? I mean, if you stop them from fighting, then that's why you get the issues with the locker room. Let them fight on the court.
The problem with that is nobody wants to see NBA players fight. I'm serious. NBA players don't want to see other NBA players fight because there's always going to be one guy that thinks he wants to fight, and he's hoping that four of his boys will step in and keep that from happening. NBA guys make way too much money. Now, you're right about the National Hockey League. Nobody's going to call them thugs for fighting because fighting is accepted. So that's why they're not thugs. I don't like the fact that people call NBA players thugs for fighting, but there's a way to have thug behavior, and a lot of times, it has nothing to do with fighting. It depends on what kind of person you're being in a situation that probably doesn't need that to happen.
Yeah, I mean, the thug term, I hate that as well, but let's be real. There have been about 10,000 NBA fights since 1965, and about 9 punches have landed, right, in all of those fights. So, like, there are no NBA fights. They are just punches thrown, but nobody connects.
They look like Whitley when she fought Kim Reese when they got into it for the sorority on a different world. I'm ready for you. And then she just swinging, and then Kim Reese goes, "You might want to land those once in a while, Whitley." That's what NBA fights would look like. Whitley versus Kim Reese in a different world. You don't want to see that.
Aaron Afalo couldn't hit a 7-footer yesterday.
Right, and he swung twice and missed them all both times. No one wants to see NBA players fight. Leave the fighting to boxers, MMA, and hockey players. They know what they're doing. Chris in St. Louis in the Frenzy.
I want to talk about Ty Haley possibly going to Minnesota, Alabama, but Seth Curry, one trick pony, really? Freddie, looks like we got a new nominee for the Playheaders Ball.
Chris in St. Louis getting it done. Well done. We don't need to add anything to that. That is the perfect way to end the Frenzy. It was upset special once again Wednesday night in college basketball, and something happened tonight that had not happened in 38 years. That's next on ESPN Radio.
This is Freddie and Fitzsimmons on ESPN Radio.
And on the ESPN app.
15 on the shot clock. Shake running it. Down to 10. He waves off the screen. He's going to go one-on-one with Austin Reeves. Shake floats it good. 45 seconds left. 79-73.
That was the call on Mustang Sports Network by Learfield Sports as SMU takes down number 7 Wichita State. First road win for the Mustangs against a top 10 team since January 16th. 1982, when they beat number 10 Houston. Meyer Metcalf, that's him. Freddie Cohen, that's me. It's Freddie and Fitzsimmons, presented by Progressive Insurance on ESPN Radio and the ESPN app. Let's bring in the head coach of the Mustangs at SMU, Tim Jankovich, who does a great job of this program year in and year out. He's here thanks to Shell Pencil Performance Line. Coach, you said before tonight's game on the road in Wichita that your team had to be near perfect to have a chance to win. After winning 83-78, how near perfect was your team tonight?
Well, I think I was right. I mean, when you look at it, I think they've lost about once every 4 years at home. And when you have a number like that, you know you have to play just absolutely fantastic to win. But thank you for pointing out the last time that we beat the top 10. Little history there. But I also appreciate I got to catch up on all the scores across the country because I hadn't gotten a chance to do that. So thank you for that. But you're right. We needed to play almost perfect, and we did. We didn't turn it over. We shot great, rebounded good enough, handled pressure all night long, and really dictated and controlled the tempo, which we really had to do, particularly on the floor.
Coach, Meyer Metcalf here. When you have a guy like Shake Milton and he shoots 42% from the three-point line last year, not many people expect a guy like that to continue to improve, and that's what he's doing this year. What has been the key to the strides he's made from last season?
Well, one thing is roles different. You know, last year we had six kind of interchangeable parts, and we had a lot of guys that could make a play, a lot of guys could score, and then we lost half of those guys, and one of them early in Shimmy Ogilvy, and the other two are in the NBA. So we lost half of our whole team, basically. So Shake was the point guard last year and did an amazing job of controlling everything and great passing, great decisions, and then shot the ball. It was, a lot of equal shooting numbers in terms of attempts, but this year with only three guys returning from the whole team, obviously he's got a different role, and so he's asked willingly to score a lot more, to shoot more. And another thing about him is he works so incredibly hard. We've had so many guys that have come through here in the last several years that not only practice hard, but they show up daily and put in just a tremendous amount of extra time. And some of the guys, that it paid off for last year, Sterling Brown got drafted. Shimmy Ogilvy was like almost inhuman in his work ethic. And some of the younger guys have seen that. And now Shake is one of those guys. He's in there every single morning getting extra shots. And when you do that, it pays off sometimes, and you do something incredible like he did tonight.
He certainly did. 33 points, 11-14 shooting from the field for Shake Milton, the head coach of SMU, Tim Jankovich. They beat number 7 Wichita State 83-78, joining Freddie Cohen and Meyer Metcalf on ESPN Radio. Coach, how are you able to do this when Jerry Foster, your second leading scorer, did not return to this game after getting injured less than 6 minutes into the game?
Well, the first thing is we all had to recover emotionally from it, myself included. He's such a big part of our team, and he's such a winner, and he's so versatile, and he does so many things that have helped us win over the last several years. So it was a devastating blow. We're hoping, we don't know yet the severity. I know that it's fairly severe, and obviously it took him out of the game, but we don't know lengthwise. But that made it even more amazing to me that one of our only three returning players, one of our only three guys with real experience here, is gone for 35 minutes.
Wow.
And the guys, and we're already kind of thin anyway because of, probation numbers. We're still on limited scholarship numbers, so we're a little thin always. And when he went down, that was a tremendous blow. And for everybody to do what they did, we had guys playing out of position that never played certain positions, and we're just kind of piecing it together as best we can, and they did an amazing job.
Your team is obviously, it's a big win tonight. You have a solid Houston team in your league, obviously Cincinnati and Wichita State. Is this the kind of year where the American can make a statement and enhance its national profile?
Oh, my gosh, yes. How about where do you take a look at Central Florida? I mean, they can hold – I swear they're going to hold somebody to 9 points for the whole game. I swear. I hope it's not us. But I'm telling you, you can go 20 minutes and not get a not even look at the basket. So they're awfully good, as you mentioned, Houston. But it doesn't just stop there. There are so many good teams, and there's some great teams. And, I can't imagine not having multiple postseason, not only NCAA, and multiple NIT teams. I think it's the league is fantastic this year. Really is.
You and I have a lot in common, Coach. We're basketball fans, we're basketball junkies, but we also love the city of Montreal. What's your favorite spot in Montreal to go to?
That's a good question. I don't know. I think probably Old Montreal.
Yes.
I loved it. When we were up there, I just thought it was so amazing and beautiful and obviously old. It's in the name. It's old, but, mm-hmm. You just feel like you're in old Europe, but you're not. And, it was such a cool experience. So I would probably say that area.
Yeah, it sounds good. Well, Coach, whether it was in English or in French, your team did it tonight against Wichita State and breaking that long winning streak that they had there. Congrats on the win, Coach Jankovich, and thanks for joining us on ESPN Radio.
Thank you guys very much.
Tim Jankovich, the head coach of SMU, like I mentioned, first top 10 win over a team on the road since 1982. Myron, they normally don't play zone defense. They went to it a lot tonight, and they were able to take down a Wichita State team, not only number 7 in the country, being in the top 10 team, that's one thing, but Wichita State had won 67 of the last 68 games at home, and SMU went in there shorthanded, playing zone defense, and beat them by 5.
It's just bizarre. I mean, honestly, SMU, that's one of the best wins of any team all year. To go to Wichita State where they just don't lose. I mean, they're such a good team everywhere, but especially at home. And to lose Jerry, to lose one of the top players, it's just been a weird, weird season. Colin Sexton doesn't play. Alabama beats Auburn. I mean, Notre Dame almost beat North Carolina last weekend without Bonzi Colson and Matt Farrell. So it's just one of those weird, weird years. Everybody has to be prepared, regardless of who's on the court.
You do a great job as a part of college basketball coverage, and I've been a college basketball fan for years. We know enough coaches that are in this sport. And I talked to a buddy of mine. I won't put his name out there because if I do, he would kill me since he's a lot bigger than me. He's a head coach of a Division I program, and I said, what has it been like for you seeing how college basketball has been able, what we've been able to see? And he said, you guys used the word the other night, Freddie, when I was listening, called torture. We are tortured each and every time we get up in the morning because you know what you're dealing with in terms of opponents, but it doesn't make it any easier. But he said, that's the fun part of what we do for a living. And I said, I'm glad you find the fun in that because I get tortured watching these games. Martin, I can't even imagine what these guys are trying to do, coming up with game plans, and you're trying to win at Wichita State or win at Duke or other plays that nobody talks about because college basketball is that wide open and that balanced this year.
Yeah, I mean, that's the thing. It's one of those years where this will be a great draft, a lot of real talent, but the team's no real great team, so it's just opening everything up. And then in conference play, you have the familiarity factor, where teams, they understand schematically what they have to deal with a lot of times because they've seen these teams in the past. What's interesting about Wichita State is they're new to the American, so
yeah. This
is a new situation for every team in that league. So SMU, like I said, maybe one of the best wins, one of the top 5 wins that we've seen this season.
How cool was that he said at SMU, we have 2 players in the NBA?
Yeah, wild.
You would not have been able to say that about SMU basketball really the last 20 years before last year. He's got 2 dudes in the NBA getting NBA paychecks, and that's not going to stop anytime soon with Coach Tim Jankovich. Great, great stuff to listen to him. Thanks to the Shell Pennzoil Performance Line. By the way, you missed our conversation with him. Subscribe to the podcast and listen to the ESPN app, Apple Podcasts, as well as TuneIn. So you got a chance to know a little bit about SMU. There's an NBA team out there that's playing extremely well that you refuse to hear about. Well, you're going to hear about it because I got problems with you people not wanting to hear about it. That's next on ESPN Radio. Freddie Coleman and Myron Metcalf on Freddie and Fitzsimmons on ESPN Radio, Sirius XM Channel 80, as well as the ESPN app, presented by Progressive Insurance. Drivers who switch to Progressive can save an average of $620. Yeah, the Cleveland Cavaliers get a lot of attention for their frailties lately. As a matter of fact, we'll talk about them coming up in 15 minutes. They're in third place in the Eastern Conference. Guess who's in fourth? The Miami Heat, only a half game behind, and they've won 8 out of the last 10 games. Who are the Fighting Eric Spoelstras? Let's find it from Ira Winderman, who does a great job covering the Heat for the South Florida Sun Sentinel. He is here thanks to Shell Pinto Performance Line. All right, Ira, for those who don't know, who are the Fighting Eric Spoelstras doing all of this for the Miami Heat so far this season?
You know, Freddie, before I even get to that, I did what you just said. I got back to my hotel room. I checked the standings because I could not believe that the Heat really are only a half a game behind LeBron and Love and Wade. This makes no sense. It makes no sense. I'll let you get to that in 15 minutes from now. But here's the thing. We were even sitting at shoot-around today talking to Eric Spoelstra saying, okay, coach, they're going to name the All-Star starters tomorrow. Then you've got to lobby coaches around the league for the reserves by next Tuesday. Who's your all-star? And he really took a long pause, and he said, maybe Goran Dragic. But honestly, with the start we had, I wouldn't be expecting anyone. I mean, this is the prototypic ensemble regular season team, maybe similar to Mike Budenholzer's team in Atlanta a few years back, where they can make noise by playing as an ensemble team. But at that moment of truth, you just don't know if they have that one guy, but they're having a good time right now. And guys, this goes back to Eric Spoelstra. He gets teams to overachieve, and that's what he's doing right now with this group.
Does that element that you don't have a bunch of superstars, you got a bunch of guys who really had to scrap to get into the league, Josh Richardson, Hassan Whiteside, does that bring this group together and make them play better together?
Oh, yeah. It's an interesting story. They all approach it as equals. Teams say that in fellowship and all those other words. And then usually it's guys, get me the bad word ball, you know, and I don't want to play at the end. That's why we had drama over this last week with this team. Hassan Whiteside, prior to tonight, had been back for 10 games after missing 13 with a bone bruise on his knee. In half of those games, he did not play a single fourth quarter minute. And this is not like Steph Curry not playing because of blowout. This is because of other choices, and it's been really hard on Hassan to adjust to the fact that he's not the team star, that he's one among equals, that Kelly Olynyk might be the big man of choice, Bam Adebayo might be the big man of choice. For Eric Spoelstra to get all these guys, to get really 12 men on a string like he's been doing it, you know, with his game day rosters, it really speaks to that. And yet, guys, I do wonder, come the playoffs, when you need that one guy to step forward. I mean, honestly, if you were to put 5-6 beat writers in a room and say, last play for the Heat in the playoff game, who gets the ball? I bet you'd have 5 or 6 different answers.
Spot on by Ira Winderman, who covers the Miami Heat for the South Florida Sun Sentinel, joining Freddie Coleman and Meyer Metcalf on ESPN Radio. Ira, in your opinion, who should be that guy that gets the ball at the end of games?
I think it should be Goran Dragic, just because he's been a third-team All-NBA player, because he's, if you had a chance to catch Eurobasket this summer, he led Slovenia to the Eurobasket championship in a nation that's not as big as most major American cities. So he has that pedigree to do it. He's also 31 years old. He is a bit on the downside also. So that's the thing. And he's too unselfish. If you even remember when Slovenia won the Euro Championship, Luka Doncic, who likely will be among the first picks, if not the first pick in the NBA draft, was allowed to be even the star of that team. He's too unselfish in moments like that. That's why I don't know. You don't know what direction it's coming at, which is why Eric Spoelstra ran the exact same play in games against Utah and Toronto and won at the end with different players, Josh Richardson against Utah, Wayne Ellington against Toronto, making the winning plays. Because the other team is not saying, we got to focus on this guy or that guy. The other team's coming out of the huddle and going, who the heck are these guys?
Ira, we saw the Clippers-Rockets situation. Would Miami be the team that you would fear the most coming through a secret tunnel with James Johnson and Bam Adebayo on that roster?
Oh, I don't know about Bam. He's still a kid. He might be a little cautious. But, I mean, literally, every time I go up to James, I'm like, excuse me, Mr. Johnson, sir, can I ask you a question, please? And honestly, he's the nicest guy in the world. But we all know about his mixed martial arts background at 7-0. And then he'll mess you up, and that Serge Ibaka, a large man in his own, stepped backwards while getting in a fight also there and went into sort of a hockey turtling mode a little bit. Mm-hmm. So, yeah, I mean, that's what James Johnson does. This team doesn't lack for toughness. The interesting thing, like you pointed out, it's not from Hassan Whiteside. It's from guys like Justice Winslow and James Johnson and Bam Adebayo. These guys will, quite literally, talking about Tyler Johnson, stick their nose in there. I mean, I'm sure at this very moment, Tyler Johnson is still looking for that missing tooth.
I went a minute to South Florida Sun Sentinel on ESPN Radio talking about the Miami Heat, a surprising fourth seed right now in the Eastern Conference. How has the city reacted to this team?
You know, I'm going to be honest. I've been covering this team for 30 years, its entire inception, and it's the same every year. You have to wait till football's over. So, you know, it still is what it is. It's still the Dolphins stink. And Pat Riley even said this. When he came from New York, he said, I noticed the difference. Down here, football season, it's like basketball season, doesn't start till January. And what a blessing for this team. Because they were a pretty bad team through stretches of November and early December. I mean, they were losing to the Hawks and losing to the Knicks and losing to the Nets on the 29th at home by like 26 points. But then football went away in South Florida, and they arrived right on schedule. Because the other teams down there, the Dolphins, the Panthers, and the Marlins, I mean, no one is talking about any playoffs with them. This town, South Florida, needed this team at the moment, and so many people identify with them. Because they are, like you said, sort of the misfits who have came together, and people respect that. And yet, if a parent goes into a store to buy a jersey for their kid, again, same question, whose jersey do you buy? Who's the man? And the thing is, Pat Riley would trade any of them in a heartbeat for a star because he still knows that's what makes the difference.
What does Spoelstra have to do to prove that, hey, he can really coach? It wasn't just a LeBron, Chris Bosh thing, that this guy has that coaching ability with or without those superstars.
Well, I mean, it's just interesting. Even if he didn't do anything now, the misery that LeBron has put David Blatt and even now Tyronn Lue by being, you know, coach, general manager, player, owner, all of that, how difficult that is. Eric Spoelstra had to deal with Chris Bosh's blood clots, and it got a little ugly there. He had to deal with a team that let their all-time icon, the statue eventually, of Dwayne Wade leave, and yet he just says, give me whatever you got, and I'll throw it together. And everyone always points as Brad Stevens as that guy and what he's done. Well, believe me, Eric Spoelstra would love to have the wealth of talent that Brad Stevens does. He goes in there and he grinds. His team plays a grinding style. It's defense first. But like with Whiteside, he doesn't put up with anybody's BS. And that's because of the Heat structure. Mickey Arison, Pat Riley, Eric Spoelstra, all those guys have been together now for more than two decades. So he knows he has the front office support. So he can bench in Hassan Whiteside and feel strong about it. Organizationally, this is by far the strongest organization in South Florida, and because of that, it lets Eric Spoelstra carry the hammer.
He is a great follow on Twitter, Ira Heat Beat. Does a great job covering the Miami Heat for the South Florida Sun Sentinel. I'm at Ira Winderman joining Freddie Coleman and Myron Metcalf on ESPN Radio. Ira, you're a prince, my friend. Always good to talk to you, and you take care.
I love listening to you guys driving home, and I gave you a Lonzo free 15 minutes, so I feel good about myself tonight also. Thank you, guys.
You're welcome, Ira. Well done by you. He can tell he's been listening for a little bit. We talked about LeVar Ball about 2.5 hours ago. By the way, Dan Dell's hit me on Twitter saying, Spo is one of the best coaches in the NBA. Hashtag Heat continue to play great ball as a collective team. Hashtag Heat culture. I'm glad for him, Myron, real quick, that he's getting the love he deserves, but it took a LeBron James and Dwayne Wade for those guys to leave for Spo to get the credit that he deserves.
It's about time, and this is a good chance to prove it again this season.
Yeah, I mean, they keep doing this. Can you imagine Miami's a third seed above Cleveland as a fourth seed in Eastern Conference? Well, I got to pump my brakes as far as that goes, but we'll wait and see. Speaking of Cleveland, LeBron James setting the stage for not succeeding again. That's next on ESPN Radio and the ESPN app. Freddie Fitzsimmons on ESPN Radio, the ESPN app, and Sirius XM Channel 80. Freddie coming alongside Myron Metcalf and Ian Fitzsimmons. And LeBron James going through some tough times, boys and girls. Poor LeBron James. That's part of Straight Talk. Brought to you by Straight Talk Wireless. They have the best phones, best networks, no contracts. You're going to listen to what LeBron James has to say. And then you'll find exactly why he agrees with Messrs. Coleman and Metcalf about how this is completely different when it comes to the Cleveland Cavaliers having a rough stretch in January that we have seen before.
It's been very challenging, just from the simple fact of how many guys have been in and out. You know, this is a difficult, you know, year for our team. It seems like I say that every year, but this one has been much even more challenging. You know, with everybody that's been out and coming back in and the rotations and things of that nature, has been very challenging on our team. But we have to figure it out. I mean, listen, at the end of the day, we have a game every other day or every 2 days, just like everybody else in the NBA. And we have to go out and play.
3 years ago, 2 years ago, last year, it was easy to figure out. The answer was LeBron James. That guy solved a lot of problems, was able to overcome, and also they were a little bit younger and less creaky and less aging than they are right now. But now, Myron Metcalf, He looks at his team and he says, boy, Dwayne Wade can give me all that he has. That's probably not going to be enough. I don't know what we're going to get from Derrick Rose. If I could get Khloe Kardashian away from Tristan Thompson, maybe he can return to Tristan Thompson back in 2015, 2016. But now they're having a baby, so that's not going to happen. He looks around at this basketball team, and he signed off on these moves because they did not make any of these moves without his prior approval. To me, Myron, he looks around. He says the reason it seems different is because, realistically, I don't know if the guys that we have now will be enough to help me when we have to get out of Eastern Conference and if we get to the NBA Finals and do some things like we've done the past 3 years.
Yeah, I mean, I think he knows as much. I mean, there was that story with the anonymous sources on ESPN.com about, you know, not feeling confident that they can replace and figure out some of the things that they were able to correct in past years. I just think LeBron, as great as he is, and we haven't seen a player at this age with this many seasons and miles on him playing like this, I think he knows that he can't continue to bail this team out. That's the thing that happens with age. He can still be great, but it's harder to sustain that. And I think he's asking for help. Freddie, I bet they do something before the trade deadline. I think they're going to try to make a major move, which might involve sacrificing that top pick they have that they got in the Kyrie Irving draft. If you really think you could hold on to LeBron, like you may have to give that up.
I wouldn't do that.
I don't agree with that. Yeah. I wouldn't either, but that may be something you have to do, because what LeBron is saying is, if we don't get better in the next 3 months, this is my last year in Cleveland. So make a decision about what you want to do, because these guys aren't cutting it. And I think that's what he's ultimately saying. I can't get better with these guys. I'm LeBron James. I'm going to go somewhere where I can.
That sounds all good. I love what you said. When LeBron could look at the management and go, I'm LeBron James, baby. You got to help me. I'm LeBron James, son. But if I'm the Cleveland Cavaliers, whether you are a fan of Dan Gilbert or not, I am not trading that pick, hoping that's going to keep LeBron James in Cleveland. I don't know if LeBron James has made up his mind what he's going to do at the end of the year. My personal feeling says no, he has not made up his mind. He's pretty much a compartmentalizing things and keeping knowing what the big picture is, Myron, but also making sure you do day by day, because you can't get to the next day without dealing with what's in front of you right now. That being said, if I'm the Cleveland Cavaliers and I got a protected pick, courtesy of the Brooklyn Nets, I'm not parting with that. LeBron's going to make a decision one way or the other, independent of what you do with that pick. But to potentially trade that for somebody as a rent-a-player in hopes that both of those guys will still be around, that's too much of a trade. That's too much of a risk to take if I'm the Cleveland Cavaliers. Now, going back to LeBron being as great as he is, and he's still the best player in the league, although every time I turn around, that gap between him and Kevin Durant keeps closing and closing and closing. Kevin Durant's not the greatest player in the NBA, but it's not as much of a gap as it used to be between both of those guys. I don't think there's any doubt in my mind that Kevin Durant's the second best player in the league. But LeBron James looks at his situation. He says, man, Kevin Durant's still in his prime. Steph's still in his prime. Klay's still in his prime. Draymond Green's still young. He looks around. Boy, I wish Dwayne Wade was in his prime. Boy, I wish Derrick Rose was in his prime. Boy, I wish Tristan Thompson had a prime. He looks around at a lot of these guys, and he says, man, oh, man. But I signed off on this, so I'm going to have to be the one that fixes it. But he's always had the ability, Myron, to make players better. There's only so much you can do with a certain skill level that the guys that he needs to help him get across the finish line and get back to the NBA Finals.
Yeah, and he's, you know, this is where the age becomes more of a factor. Like, he had a lot of help with Kyrie. Kyrie extended his career, I think, in a lot of ways, in that he took a lot of that pressure off him. Now you lose a guy in Kyrie Irving, you're not going to replace him with Isaiah Thomas, who is a defensive liability. Tristan Thompson, you know, hasn't been the same guy. Back to the thing about the pick, though, if you're Cleveland and you've won one championship in your entire existence, right? You've had top picks. You had LeBron James. You didn't win a title that first run. You had Kyrie Irving. He wasn't going to win one by himself. I think you have to play the short game in the NBA, considering how many super teams are forming. Mm-hmm. If you're Cleveland, you've got to find a way to keep LeBron, keep him happy, and try to win another title or two before he retires, because that might be it if you're Cleveland. And I think right now LeBron's trying to send a message and saying, hey, look, he's the person in the relationship that's getting a little rocky. Like, hey, do something here if you want me to stick around. And I think that's the message that LeBron is trying to send.
Well, whatever dinner they're going to promise him, whatever candlelight, whatever lobster,
roses.
You know, yeah, whatever the roast oak of the mango thalfa, whatever they're going to have to promise LeBron James at that dinner, that may not be enough to keep him going home with you at night, because that dinner may taste good, but he doesn't want to go back home to the situation. And to that situation, Meyer Metcalf, Freddie Coleman, and Freddie Fitzsimmons on ESPN Radio, to that situation, if you're LeBron, it's still hard for him to find that guy to go to Cleveland from another team. He was able to go back to Cleveland and have that trade facilitated where Kevin Love joins him. Kevin Love wanted out of Minnesota. Minnesota said, well, we're going to get something in return. And now they got a part of their big three with Andrew Wiggins, along with Karl-Anthony Towns, part of that, and Jimmy Butler, part of that big three in Minnesota. So they were able to luck out with that because Kevin Love wanted out, and that was the perfect two-man turn to be a three-man with him and Kyrie Irving. But the minute Kyrie left, and Myron, you know this, players talk. I wonder how many guys talked to Kyrie Irving and said, hey, bro, man, why did you really leave? Everybody's saying you left because you wanted your own team. What's the real reason? And I'm sure Kyrie probably said, look, at a certain point, as great as he is, it's a short shelf life trying to play with him. Chris Bosh even warned Kevin Love about that, saying, hey, playing with LeBron is great, but it's not the easiest thing to do. And now you're trying to do that in Cleveland? It was a lot easier in Miami. It's harder in Cleveland. And I wonder how much of that what LeBron James said about this being a challenging year and a harder year is maybe setting up for, if we don't do it again, I can't stay here because I can't get the guys I need to make sure my basketball sunset is going to be a good sunset than trying to do that in Cleveland.
Yeah, I think he's definitely, this is definitely about the future in so many ways. I don't know how many people are consulting Kyrie Irving. I mean, clearly, I think LeBron is hard to play with. There are a lot of stories about that. But I think people listen to Kyrie Irving and then they go, this is also the dude who thinks that the earth is flat. So, you know, let's not get ahead of ourselves. Let's get a second and third source.
Touche.
On whatever this dude is saying, right? So I think that's a part of it as well. But I think LeBron is still great and has a couple more years left of being one of the top two or three players in the NBA.
Sure.
You got to take advantage of that. Try to if you're Cleveland, because this won't happen again. But I think LeBron is sending messages. He sent messages in 07.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, in 2010, he sent messages that he was probably going to go back to Cleveland. This guy is pretty obvious when he's looking to make a move, and he's not happy. And I think that's what he's communicating right now.
That has to be some kind of situation. If you're Dan Gilbert, if you're the Cleveland Cavaliers, if you're the city of Cleveland, if you're the state of Ohio, everybody is grateful that he was able to break that 50-plus year string of not having a world championship in that city.
Yeah.
But at the same time, I wonder how much of, you know, what's wrong with us? Why can't you want to continue to do it here? Team LeBron is more important than Team Cleveland or Team Ohio or Team Cavaliers.
All day.
Right, and if you didn't realize that before when he left the first time, it's really going to be crystallized when I believe he does it again. I would love for him to stay there. I think it's great for the NBA that he does stay there. But, you know, if it's not great for LeBron James, that's not going to be in his future and not in the Cavaliers' future, too. And that's part of Straight Talk Wireless. They have nationwide coverage on America's largest and most dependable 4G LTE networks. Keep those great tweets coming in at the 1-800-Flowers.com Twitter feed. Myron's handle at Metcalf by ESPN. My handle at Coleman ESPN. So Big Ben was trolled by Jacksonville, but not by the Jaguars. That sweet thing is next on ESPN Radio. Yeah. Freddie coming to Meyer Metcalf on Freddie and Fitzsimmons, presented by Progressive Insurance on ESPN Radio, the ESPN app, and SiriusXM Channel 80. If you missed anything that we said, you want to hear it again, you missed any interviews that you are sorry that you missed the first time, subscribe to the podcast. You can do that in the Listen tab of the ESPN app, Apple Podcasts, as well as TuneIn. So Jacksonville, they love in life right now, getting ready to play in the AFC Championship game on Sunday, 3:05 Eastern time on CBS, when they take on the New England Patriots in New England. Blake Bortles is not listening to any criticism. You can talk about him. You can talk about his bad quarterbacking. Don't talk about his mother. But right now, he does not care because they're saving the moment about to play for a championship.
Personally, you know, I don't care. I look at it as, you know, it's an incredible opportunity to continue to be able to play football at this time of year. And I think it's pretty awesome and special to be able to, you know, share this with the group of guys we got in that locker room, because I think everybody knows it's not going to be the same group next year. You know, guys can go at any time. So I think to kind of enjoy, you know, continuing to play football, obviously, you know, for the longest that we have in a long time, and enjoy it with these guys every single day. You know, we're one of four teams that gets to come out and practice, you know, on a Wednesday today, and that's special. I mean, it's something that everybody dreams of, and it's something that everybody works towards. So for us to be able to be here and be in this position, it's pretty awesome.
Blake Bortles was trolled by more than a couple of players in the last month or so. Nothing like this, what Ben Roethlisberger had to deal with or sort of deal with. Sonati's Bakery is a Jacksonville Beach-based shop. They put on Facebook this week that it shipped Ben Roethlisberger 7 freshly baked turnovers thanks to him turning over the ball 7 times in 2 games in the pair of losses to Jacksonville. They wrote on Facebook, I'm not making this up. I cannot make up anything that's good. Dear Big Ben, we wanted to thank you for the amazing season so far. Beating you this year not once but twice in the Berg, well, that was amazing. We appreciated the turnovers you gave us over our season. So in return, we wanted you to get a taste of 7 turnovers. So here are our very best apple, blueberry, and cherry turnovers. Sincerely, the amazing city of Jacksonville, or as you know it, Saxonville.
I like it. That's creative.
They sent a handwritten note to him. Thank you. Wow.
That's correct. What do you think he said? I mean, did he respond? Has he tweeted anything about it? Does he care?
He hasn't said anything about it. Put it this way. Not a thing about it. But at the same time, look, if you're going to troll me that way, but I get free food out of the whole deal?
Oh, yeah.
And I've seen the turnovers, Myron, on Facebook. And I'm eating them turnovers. I'm thinking, look, hey, I don't like throwing 7 turnovers, but you're going to send me food, and it's this good, I'm going to eat it. That's how I look at it.
Yeah, he should take it in stride. I mean, that's creative. And what else are you going to do? I mean, right. Come on. Mm-hmm. That's fun.
Don't lose.
Yeah, basically twice at home. Twice at home to Jacksonville. That's the deal.
Wow. But 7, Sonati's Bakery. If I'm ever in Jacksonville, and I've been in Jacksonville a long time, I might have to stop by because seeing these turnovers, just seeing them will put 10 pounds on you immediately. Just seeing that, what they're able to send to Big Ben Roethlisberger, who, by the way, real quick, with the Pittsburgh Steelers, they fired their offensive coordinator, Todd Haley, today. And you and I both agree, at least I think we're on the same page here, Myron, that he was made to be a scapegoat for the problems of whatever problems he had with Ben Roethlisberger. And we knew exactly where Mike Tomlin was going to side. He was going to side with his quarterback and not with the outgoing offensive coordinator, that is Todd Haley.
Yeah, I mean, Tomlin was always going to go with Roethlisberger. They got a few more years, I think, with him, and they got some young pieces. They got to make the most of the next 2 to 4 years, I think, with this franchise, and they know it.
Ben Roethlisberger, he said he's coming back for 2018, which was not a surprise at all. Everybody pretty much knew that he was going to do that. But I wonder how much Ben Roethlisberger, what his standing is in the locker room, because after they lost on Sunday, and what he said ever since about not having the authority to change play calls, he essentially threw his offensive coordinator under the bus. I wonder how much of that is not playing well, Myron, in the Pittsburgh Steelers locker room.
Well, Todd Haley ain't throwing passes to me. So if I'm his skill guys and I'm getting the ball handed off from Roethlisberger, I'm with him, you know. So I think that whatever he said is what goes, you know. And I think that's just the way it goes. That's a franchise that doesn't change head coaches. Mm-hmm. They have stability.
Yeah.
And you're going to be vulnerable in a situation where you don't get off to a great start for the second time against a Jacksonville team that has your number. It wasn't all Todd Haley, of course.
Right.
That defense has to explain how it gave up 45 points. But that is the perception, I think, that Haley could have made better calls and given Ben more freedom, and they could have won that game.
Well, why don't we attach that to Keith Butler, the defensive coordinator, as well?
Because I think people are looking more how Ben played. And it's easier to look at the offensive coordinator and blame him for your star quarterback's woes. And it's easier to say, hey, if Shazier doesn't get hurt, then all of a sudden the Pittsburgh defense reverts to what it was. So it's easier to explain what happened defensively, harder to explain with the slower start on offense.
Bill Polian, ESPN NFL front office insider, says this firing goes a lot deeper in that organization.
There's a lot of talk, especially on the internet, about Mike Tomlin underachieving. Mike Tomlin didn't underachieve. Haley didn't underachieve. The only part of that football team that underachieved was the defense. And that was missing Shazier for this last month of the season in this playoff run. So in that sense, this record and the way this season finished is understandable and somewhat puzzling in the sense that the offensive coordinator was responsible for the greatest offensive performance in Steeler playoff history is out the door. So it has to be personality driven or some other, there's some other internal issue in the organization.
Either way, this may be only step one. What problems may be ailing the Pittsburgh Steelers, especially if the new guy coming in, the quarterback's coach replacing Todd Haley, is not better than the old guy. By the way, Brian Freeman on the other side, hit me on Twitter. He says, I love Jacksonville talking. As what Muhammad Ali used to say, hashtag rumble, young man, rumble. There's going to be a lot of that on Sunday when both of these teams get together. Jacksonville's going to be who they are. The Patriots are going to be who they are. Either way, there's going to be a lot of fussing and cussing on Sunday. Good old-fashioned game hate. But, Myron, I can't wait to see that when both of these two get together on Sunday in New England.
I love it because, obviously, everyone's picking New England. You should pick New England, mm-hmm. considering their history and what they have. From a personnel standpoint, but I love a young trash talking team with nothing to lose.
Yeah.
And if you're New England, I would much rather play Pittsburgh, a team I know, a team I've defeated, than this sort of mysterious Jacksonville team that really doesn't care. Doesn't care what you think about them. Doesn't care if you think they're going to lose. Doesn't care what Vegas says. That's a dangerous group.
My Metcalf, Freddie Coleman on Freddie and Fitzsimmons on ESPN Radio. Speaking of not caring what people think, that brings us to former NBA player Matt Barnes. Anybody that saw him play, you know he didn't give a about anything or anybody what they had to say about him. He was going to play the way he played, and he was going to get after no matter what. You will not have to question his loyalty, even though he's about to give up chicken McNuggets from McDonald's. Why is he doing that? I'll be glad to tell you. He's boycotting McDonald's because they left the son of Shaquille O'Neal off this year's high school McDonald's All-American team. I wish I could say I was making that up. He went on Instagram to say, Dear McDonald's, seeing that you made a huge mistake by leaving Shaquille O'Neal off the McDonald's All-American team, I will no longer allow my twins to eat your six-piece chicken nugget Happy Meals. I hope you're happy. I know the twins won't be when I tell them, no more nuggets, SMH, hashtag, no more nuggets. Oh, my goodness.
Well, just McDonald's should be glad it was a tweet because McDonald's, if he calls you and says he's coming, trust us.
Yeah.
He's on his way. Yeah. Y'all should run.
Ask Derek Fisher. have I said too much? Have I gone too far? Bad
Just
Freddy.
Run if he calls and says he's coming.
Yeah, bad Freddy. Bad Freddy. Myron, it's a pleasure, my man. Go kick behind on the weekend, okay?
Hey, thanks a lot. Thanks for everything. Appreciate
Absolutely.
It.
My pleasure. This has been Freddie and Fitzsimmons on the mighty ESPN Radio. Take care. God bless. No matter the situation, when Matt Barnes is after you or not, always keep cool.